Good morning and welcome to the 33rd meeting of the Rural Affairs and Island Committee in 2023. Before we begin, can I remind anyone using electronic devices to please switch them to silent. Our first item of business today is consideration of the Wine Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2024. And I welcome Mary Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Islands Reform and... Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands. And I would invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for inviting me to speak about these regulations today. The purpose of this instrument is to amend legislation relating to the marketing and production of wine and other wine products. Firstly, to introduce rules that will regulate how products marketed as ice wine must be produced, which include a definition of ice wine. And secondly, to update the lists of approved enological practices that can be used to produce and conserve wine and other wine products marketed in Scotland. Now, the relevant existing legislation happens to be EU retained law, which from the 1st of January will be known as assimilated law. The ice wine provision in this instrument is required as the UK is acceding to the Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership. This provision is required for compliance with the terms of the CPTPP. Although ice wine is not produced in the UK, it is imported and a definition for that is required to ensure that consumers can identify products that are made according to specified criteria that apply to its production. This provision amends Regulation EU 2019/33 to provide that products may only be marketed in Scotland as ice wine or similar terms if they have been produced exclusively from grapes naturally frozen on the vine, and the same provision is being made across Great Britain. Now, also included in the instrument are changes to approved enological practices. Regulation EU 2019/934 authorises specified enological practices that can be used to produce and conserve wine. The instrument amends this regulation to update these practices to reflect updates to the International Organisation of Vine and Wines approved methods, which largely are already existing in EU law. The UK is a member of the OIV and its recommendations form the basis of domestic EU and many third countries' wine production rules, and this will ultimately ensure that wine producers and importers have access to the latest technological developments and winemaking practices in line with EU law. The UK and Welsh governments are making the same changes for England and Wales. Before bringing forward this instrument, the Scottish Government carried out a consultation on citizen space and directly contacted the major stakeholders too, and that consultation ran from the 31st of August to the 8th of October. The major stakeholders, such as Wine GB and the Wine and Spirit Association, didn't respond, but they had, however, previously responded to the UK Government's consultation on these proposals, and the response to that was generally positive. There were five respondents in total to the Scottish consultation who were individual members of the public, and the responses advised either a positive impact or no impact of the proposed regulatory changes. The instrument was also notified to the WTO Technical Barriers to Trade Committee, and no comments were received to that. So I hope the comments have been helpful in outlining what this instrument is for today, and I'm of course happy to take any questions that the committee might have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Members, any questions? Rachel Hamilton.
Just, I mean, this is a new one to me, Cabinet Secretary, but you mentioned the enological practices and restrictions that will be brought in with this particular regulation. And I just wondered if, for the committee, you might be able to explain what those were. But also, you said that some of the responses said that there would be no impact at all. But is that because there's no real data on the amount of ice wine that is consumed in Scotland?
In relation to that, and just to give a bit more detail, so as I was outlining in my opening comments there, this is essentially split into two parts. So that definition of ice wine, there wouldn't really be impact on producers here. It's not something that's made here. It is quite a niche product, and is I think it's largely produced in Canada, in countries like Canada and Germany. So there, again, from the consultation responses and that we'd received, there wouldn't be any impact in relation to that. And in terms of that definition, there is obviously an impact on those producers who may have, who wouldn't be part of that definition now, who are using artificially frozen grapes as part of that. That again doesn't affect our industry, as far as I'm aware, across GB. But I don't know if Kevin would have any more to add in relation to that. The enological practices, again, the changes that are being proposed there, there have been, I think, broadly welcomed, and there was a positive reaction to that, because these are changes that have already been implemented in the EU, and it means that I think there was, this was broadly seen to be benefiting, whether it's exporters, bottlers, and means that it would, and it was seen as encouraging innovation in relation to that as well. So they were broadly welcome. But again, I don't know, Kevin, if there's anything else you want to add to that, or.
No,
if I've
No, I think you have adequately covered it. It's, that was exactly it, just summarised. The changes are about processes, practices and restrictions that we need to look at on logical.
Kevin, what are they? I mean, that's
well,
what I'm asking.
Well, they're quite technical in nature, and there's an annex in the SSI. I mean, it's basically about improving standards and regulation. The OIV meet annually, and they make these changes after consulting their own industry. And they have, I think it's a seven-stage step to go through before they all agree them. But they are quite technical in nature, and there's a whole list on the SSI itself. I don't know, Judith, do you want to expand on the actual changes themselves?
As you say, Kevin, they're set out in the Regulation 934 of 2019, and this inserts some new provisions that slightly tweaks some provisions to update them with the most recent files that the OIV have passed. These are resolutions that are passed, including the UK, who vote as part of the OIV. As to the technical detail of what these do, they are set out in the SSI itself. But
okay.
OK, we now move on to the formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument and invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S6M11343.
Formally moved, Convener.
Does any member wish to debate the motion? No. Is the committee content to recommend approval of this instrument? We are, thank you. And finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off our report on our deliberations on this affirmative SSI? Thank you. That completes consideration of the affirmative instrument. We'll now suspend for 10 minutes to allow witnesses to change over. Thank you. We now have our second round table on the Agriculture and Rural Communities Scotland Bill. Today's evidence session will focus on the production of high quality food, one of the objectives in the bill, but we'll also go on to move to discuss the bill more broadly. We have up to 3 hours scheduled for the discussion, and this morning I'd like to welcome to the meeting Leslie Mitchell, the Policy Director for Sustainable Food Trust, Tim Bailey, the Chief Executive from the Scottish Agriculture Organisation Society. We have Professor Jenny McDermott, the Director from the Interdisciplinary Centre for Health, Wellbeing and Nutrition from the Rowett Institute, Joe Hine, the Policy Manager from Scotland Food and Drink, Johnny Hall, Director of Policy from the National Farmers Union of Scotland, Pete Ritchie, Director from Nourish Scotland, Sarah Miller, the Chief Exec of Quality Meats Scotland, and last not least, David Thompson, Chief Exec of Food and Drink Federation Scotland. So we're going to kick off the themes, and I'm going to ask you all a question on one of the four main objectives, and that is around the production of high quality food. So what is meant by the production of high quality food, and how do we define it, and do we need to define it? I'll kick off with Joe, who's looking.
Wonderful. Do I need to press the button?
You don't need to operate your mics.
Oh, great. OK. Thank you. How do we define high quality food? I think that's a really important question, and it's difficult to answer simply. Certainly, from our point of view, there's different lenses, and one of the lenses we use as Scotland Food and Drink is that of the customer, and the customer is a broad entity. You know, you have a local market, your domestic market, your communities, if you like, within Scotland, and they are best served, we would say, by short, transparent supply chains as direct as possible from farm to fork, and you see farmers producing that kind of what we would all probably recognise as very high quality ingredients, high quality food that can go into those communities potentially directly through things like box schemes or things like farm gate sales. And then you've got, by extension, the customers who are in the public sector, your schools, your hospitals, which again can be served really well by high quality food. And high quality in that sense doesn't necessarily mean your perfectly shaped carrots and vegetables. It could be all manner of things. They're full of nutrition, they're serving the local economy, they're provided by producers into processes potentially for transforming into a state that a school can take in. For example, school kitchens can't take dirty vegetables by and large. They need it to be processed to some degree, and then they can use it similarly with hospitals. And then you've got further extension into sort of your hospitality and your retail markets across Scotland. And again, they will have their own specification. There's some argument for that specification being widened, I would say, in some of those markets in terms of what can be accepted as high quality. And then, of course, you've got your global markets. And again, if we're customer-led, we would look at, for example, in Dubai recently, the demand for lamb, and specifically, I think, in that case, halal lamb. And that high quality for them is defined by certain standards in the production which they would require. And again, with Scotch whisky, you might have a requirement around single malt and high quality. So it's difficult to answer, but we would say, as a broad principle, it should be led by your customers, led by your markets in terms of the quality that they would be looking for. And as well, hopefully, with some agreement from a production side as to what the production standards are for Scotland as a whole to be recognised as a place for good quality, high quality food and drink, which is nutritious, which is supports the economy, which has value within the supply chain for the farmers, for the producers, and which has environmental sustainability embedded within it as well.
Thank you. Does there need to be a definition on the face of the bill, Johnny?
I don't think you can actually define it on the face of the bill. I think high-quality food production is fundamental to what the bill's purpose is all about. It is clearly one of the four key themes within the bill and the objectives of the bill. And I don't think you can separate high-quality food production from the others, being climate and biodiversity and indeed underpinning rural communities. I would echo everything that Joe's just said. But I would take it a bit further in the sense that, first and foremost, high quality has to have at its core the integrity of that the product. So there's absolute certainty around the safety of that food and the provenance of that food, the traceability issues. And I think we're already incredibly well served in that respect, given the role and function of the standards to which we operate, both legally and in terms of our quality assurance aspects in every sector of Scottish agricultural production. So I have no issue around the fact that we are already operating to extremely high standards, both in terms of the integrity, but also then, I think more importantly, and this is what I would like to see come out of the bill and policy that then flows from the bill, is that it recognises that high quality food production is a significant component of what we're trying to achieve around things like the climate in terms of sequestration, reducing emissions, adaptation to climate change, as well as delivering for nature in terms of biodiversity, as well as delivering for rural communities in terms of having a vibrant, viable, profitable agricultural sector, farming and crofting, to underpin those communities. So I don't think it's useful at all to separate high-quality food from the other things you're trying to attain. I think they've got to be integrated in that respect. So that would be my plea. I think if we go down the route of trying to define lots of things within this bill too hard, too fast, I think we'll paint ourselves into lots of corners and possibly tie ourselves in knots for no particular gain. And I would reference that in the context of high-quality food production, but there's other things in the bill I would also say that maybe we'll come to later. The term regenerative is bound to come up in conversation. And I think if we try and nail that down to an absolutely defined sort of process or a concept, then I think, again, we are making ourselves a hostage to fortune.
The only concern I have, certainly, is that this is the bill. So we're at the business end of this now, where it's actually law, it's going to be legislation, and ultimately it's going to be framework of how agricultural payments are made. If there's no clear indication of what actually high-quality food is, you know, where do the payments go? Where does the support go? And if it's left to secondary legislation, there's very little that scrutiny can be, you know, come along with that. And you said too fast. We're quite some time from when we decided to leave CAP, the Common Agricultural Policy. So why is it too fast to have actually a clearer definition of what quality food is and what that might do to support payments?
Well, as I say, I don't think we need to have that clearer definition of high quality in the context of what we're talking about. Because we've got those standards already embedded in what we do, and we have had for decades now, we've had to have in every sector. The integrity of what we produce is not in doubt, and it does not require this bill to build further integrity into what we do. I think the key thing in this bill, in that context of high quality, is that you then embrace things like, is it high quality in terms of delivering on the other outcomes that you require? And remember, the purpose of this bill is fundamentally to deliver support that underpins either an activity and or an outcome. And therefore, I do not think that you need to have high quality absolutely nailed down on the face of the bill. That will come along with other things. And if you look at the rest of the bill, things like a code of practice for sustainable and regenerative agriculture, it doesn't say what that will be in the bill, but it does say that there will be one as part of the bill process. A rural support plan, it doesn't say what that rural support plan will be within the bill, but it does say that there will be one. And that's what will follow, and I think that's what needs to be taken a degree of time to get right. If we paint ourselves into a corner too far, too fast, then I do think we're storing up problems. This is a framework bill, as we all know, and there are some who would say a framework bill is not good enough. We need to have absolute precision in the primary legislation. I would disagree. I think we need to then use the powers to best effect in order to tackle the issues that we've got. And in that sense, you need a framework bill that's flexible and adaptable as we go forward.
Yeah, I think we've had general consensus that framework bill is the way forward. Pete Ritchie.
Thanks, Convener. I think it's bad law if we put high-quality food on the face of the bill with no intention to define it. There's two things you need to think about high-quality food. One is what's in it, in terms of nutrients, and I'll leave Jenny to talk about that. And the other thing is how it's made. You know, and what we know is that you can't have high-quality food that's made with poor animal welfare standards. You can't have high-quality food that's made with poor labour standards. You can't actually, in our view, have high-quality food that's made in a way that damages the environment, whether that's through pesticides or nutrient pollution or using more emissions, more resources than best-in-class. So in terms of high-quality food in Scotland, if we're producing beef and lamb, which are high-quality in terms of protein, they need to be best in class in terms of animal welfare, greenhouse gas emissions, contributions to nature and all that stuff. So if we're going to put it in the bill, we need to define it in the rural support plan really clearly, saying these are the indicators for high quality food and these are the targets that we want in terms of delivering high quality food.
Thank you. I've got Sarah.
Yeah, just come in there, and I think Pete's hit the nail on the head there when he said within the rural support plan, that for me is the place where you can have that definition of where high quality food comes in. I think from my memory, the rural support plan is due to be reviewed every 5 years, which aligns with how the CAP rural development plan also used to be delivered. So it gives that a time period that is long enough to give certainty whilst still being agile enough to respond to challenges that come down the wind. How I would define high quality food is food that does good for the economy, that does good things for local environments. I think one of the things that we have to remember is that Scotland is a very broad church in terms of the resource base that we produce food from. What's right in Lanarkshire will not be what's right in the Orkney Islands. So having that regional flexibility that can be delivered through the rural support plan rather than on the face of the framework bill itself, I think would be the right mechanism to go, and embedding co-design principles into that rural support plan would ensure that has designed, you know, from the bottom up, from farmers, crofters, those within the supply chain, to make sure that it is right for businesses.
Thank you. I think the lens that I find quite useful in this discussion is that of sustainable nutrition, in the sense that you have, and what I think we've already heard here, you have sustainably and regeneratively produced food that delivers the right kinds of foods for healthy diets available for all. And that becomes the overarching goal. But within that, to Pete's point, there are key outcomes that reflect the attributes of high quality food. And I do think that requires a definition, because they are the signposts of what you will then be paying for and what will be the guiding lights of your food system within Scotland. And they do include, clearly, obviously, greenhouse gas emissions and so on, but it needs to be a set of holistic outcomes that cover those different attributes of sustainably and regeneratively produced food. Thank you.
Thank you. Tim.
Thank you, Convener. I think from my point of view, you know, there's almost a subtext to here that it's kind of food production as we do now. You know, there's a degree of custom and practice here. We're a heavy legislated country, regulated country. In Scotland, huge levels of quality assurance. So, you know, at the end of the day, if we're sitting there with our primary production is traceable, meets customer expectations, as Joe was saying, is legally produced, is quality assured, then it's very much building on that. So relative to where we are with the needs of the sector to address regard to climate, and relative to the needs of where the sector needs to get with regard to nature, you know, we're at a really good level already. So, and I would certainly support previous comments that, you know, let's not put it into the face of the bill if we can't define it, unless we're going to define it as we are here already.
I've got a question from Alistair Allen and then Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Convener. Johnny Hall, you've mentioned to us in the past on the point you were making there about the importance of producing food, about the importance of the connection between support and production. So I just wonder if you can say a bit more about that in terms of producing quality food for the country. Obviously, other places have gone down a different route in terms of breaking that connection. And you have mentioned in the past also about how Scotland might pursue a different path or play a different furrow in terms of making sure that the Subsidy Control Bill didn't actually frustrate us in doing that. So can you say a bit more about that connection and what scope there is for Scotland doing something different?
Yeah, I think where we are in Scotland is where we do need to be, because what we haven't done in Scotland is broken the link between food production and delivering on our objectives and aspirations around climate and biodiversity and underpinning rural communities. And that to me, on the face of this bill, is clearly what's important. There's four inseparables in there. And if you strip out the high-quality food production, then I think you're in danger of actually losing the main tool you have to delivering the other outcomes. You need high-quality food production to be driving farming and crofting across Scotland, underpinning it financially in a sustainable way so that enables then the land management that you require to deliver on the outcomes around capturing more carbon in our soils and woodland and so on, diversification of the rural economy in terms of what we do, and of course addressing the challenges around nature restoration. These things are inseparable. But if you have not got that kernel, if you like, at the heart of that, of active farming and crofting, then it makes it really, really challenging to do. 70% of our land mass is under some form of agricultural management. And therefore, we need to be ensuring that we focus our attention on how we manage that land in an agricultural context to get all of the outcomes that we want simultaneously. I'll paraphrase the Cabinet Secretary last November, not just gone, but the previous. There is no contradiction between food, climate, biodiversity, and underpinning rural communities. And we would absolutely endorse that. You've got to stitch those together through active farming and crofting. That's the key thing for us, and that's where the focus of the support has to be. I think in terms of the second part of that, we've always been conscious about the fact that agriculture and rural development policy is devolved, quite rightly so.
We're going to stick to the four objectives at the moment, I think, and we can come to that.
I was asked about the subsidy control, but yeah, I'll come back to it.
Yeah, which is not relevant to this particular topic at the moment. I'm going to move on to a question from Ariane Burgess.
I've actually got a couple of questions. So the first one's around animal welfare and the second one is around nutrition, because that was raised. They've both been raised. So, and it's interesting that Pete, you're the only person who's really talked about animal welfare, and last week it came up extensively. And I wonder if you think it falls under high quality food. So Kirsty Jenkins from One Kind last week talked about other countries moving away from using colony cages or farrowing crates, and Cathy Dwyer from SAWC talked about how we still allow surgical procedures to be carried out on young animals without anaesthetic. And I just wonder what our thoughts are around, you know, can you call something high quality food if these kind of practices are continuing? And also, if not, how can the bill, the rural support plan, or the payment schemes ensure that high quality food meets high animal welfare standards? Anyone want to pick that up?
I speak here as an animal welfare scientist by background. I have a PhD in animal welfare science. And I would simply say that you cannot have high quality food if it is produced in systems where animals are effectively designed to suffer. And what that says to me is that there are specific red lines that might be too harsh, but things that you need to point away from and things that you need to point towards. The concept of animal welfare has shifted quite significantly in the last 20, 30 years from being about reducing suffering or enriching environments to actually providing animals with a good life. And I would argue that caged systems cannot provide animals that are complex beings with brains with a good life. And secondly, that we have fantastic pasture-based systems that are very capable of enabling animals to live good lives while producing good quality food. And in some cases, for example, in ruminant production, providing much more complex nutrient availability to people through longer-lived and pasture-reared animals. So if I were my choice, I would be saying get rid of the cages in this. But I am also aware that this is a framework bill.
So that's something about clearer definition around what we mean by high quality food.
And I don't think that we should be rewarding poor welfare systems in any kind of payment.
I've got Sarah and then Joe. Yeah,
and I just wanted to, there's a really, really good example of some of the different complexities involved in what we're trying to do here around a food system and the rural support bill. Because, you know, you mentioned there, Leslie, about, you know, animals that are living longer. one of the key ways to reduce our emissions, particularly from the ruminant sector, is to reduce our days to slaughter. You know, that is evidence-based. But actually, animals who live longer, like you say, they're doing different things. And I think that's really important in terms of this discussion. This is not a clear-cut, you know, do this and that will be the outcome. There are trade-offs and intricacies. And I think one of the things that we have to remember, that, you know, bringing back into what Johnny said, is that at the end of the day, we're dealing with businesses. And, you know, how we enable businesses to provide high animal welfare systems, how we make it easy. Some of the other elements of the bill in terms of, you know, things like CPD, how we support businesses to remain viable in parts of the world that are really difficult to run businesses in. You know, parts of the Outer Hebrides where things like getting animals off the island to go to auction markets, you know, those have animal welfare implications. So making sure that we have a holistic policy that enables high welfare to become the priority is really important, but it's not also as easy as it always looks.
Thank you. Bring Joe and then Pete and a supplement from Rachel.
It's, thank you. It's just to say, I guess, that high quality, as we've touched on, has various elements, and welfare is clearly one of those elements. But because there are so many elements, it is tricky, as Johnny's touched on, to define it up front. So it's, I guess the question is almost back, would not defining it now present a risk to later defining it in a way that's implementable? And if that is a risk, then perhaps some more work does need to be done at this stage. But if not, I would imagine that the plans, the delivery plans that come out of the framework bill could, within their function, serve to define that in a way that does capture what we all recognise as a really important part of it, which is welfare. Because welfare links to quality, links to markets, but actually also links to just integrity, which is really important in production.
And Pete?
Just to add to that about markets, animal welfare is really important for animals. It's also really important for farmers, because increasingly that's what people are going to be looking for, is demonstrable high animal welfare standards. And whether that's getting pigs off slats, or whether it's giving all cattle access to pasture, or whether it's getting cow and calf dairies going, what producers are going to need in Scotland is to support to transition their systems, because that's an expensive business. So if we're going to go for animal welfare, has to be part of high quality, and we have to support producers to be best in class on animal welfare, and not to rest on our laurels and say we're quite good. We have to be best.
Can I just add a supplement on that? Why should it be on the face of the bill? Why would animal welfare outlining what we want to achieve not be on the face of the bill? Why would secondary legislation be a better place for it? Surely if we know what animal welfare concerns are just now, why do we need to wait till secondary legislation, where we don't actually have the ability to scrutinise it at the level that we do through primary legislation? Joe?
It's a fair point, but I guess the delay there would be you'd have to define it across all those different areas, not just welfare. You'd have to do all of the work that will need to be done at some point to define it and have some form of assessment ability linked to that criteria. But, I mean, I think it's a fair point in that objectives generally are meant to be quite specific and measurable, and as they currently stand, it's not particularly, you would say, just by having it. But by keeping it general, more general, you do then allow it to be defined at a later date with having that extra work, having that extra dialogue. And dialogue like this is so important, but it would certainly take time to come up with those definitions, spell it out and have it there. I'm not enough of an expert on the parliamentary process to understand whether that's better done now or later, but I sense from other people that they feel that it would be better done later.
I'm going to bring in Rachel for a supplement, and then Jim, and bring Johnny back here.
Well, I just wondered the panel's view on animal welfare and health being missing from the list of objectives, because it's not in the best interest of farmers to practice bad animal welfare, but it is in their best interest to ensure that they make savings, that they produce the best food, that they adopt technology, and they use preventative health measures such as vaccination or, you know, I suppose, gene technology. But it isn't on the face of the bill. And I think if we're looking at, you know, some people are saying it's too prescriptive, but other people are saying we need more detail. And I don't think we should be afraid of ensuring that we do have some of the best quality produce in Scotland. I just want to, it's really a comment for Sarah, because she talked about CPD.
Oh. Yeah, and I think where I would go with that one is that going back to the rural delivery plan, I think if you can link those objectives to how that rural delivery plan will be delivered over the 5 years in terms of funding support, in terms of grant aid that helps achieve those objectives, it also allows you to align in with things like CPD and also innovation. We know that this space around data, technology and transition is incredibly fast moving. So by having it in the rural delivery plan instead of being on the face of the bill, it allows you to be a lot more focused and nimble, but actually enable those businesses to move with the most modern science, technology and evidence that they have. So suppose it's about the framework bill and how we frame at a higher level what we're looking to deliver, provide that enablement for the powers to then deliver that rural support plan that actually links then to businesses. I do think animal welfare is incredibly important when we talk about high quality food. There's a lot of evidence that says that animals that are producing high welfare systems are also, you know, have lower greenhouse gas emissions, are also more productive, you know, so it's better business. It's that kind of triple bottom line, triple win, which we shouldn't be afraid of doing. But I do think when this space is moving so quickly, we want to make sure we give businesses the best chance to stay ahead of the pack and, you know, delivered through that aligned rural delivery plan.
Jim, do you want to bring your supplementary in just now?
I'll wait till I hear what Johnny said and then I'll come back.
Okay, well, I've got Kate to come in as well on this. So, Johnny.
I'd like to support everything that's been said by other panellists, but then to take it on to, first of all, your own question, convener, about why don't we have a definition of animal health and welfare on the face of the bill. I think that would pose some significant questions about ensuring it's that definition being compatible with every other piece of legislation which covers animal health and welfare anyway. We have significant legislation in place that requires certain things and standards, and quite rightly so. That then takes me on to Rachel's point about, again, why isn't animal health and welfare on the face of the bill? If we take this bill into that secondary legislation phase and how we then distribute support, one of the key elements that we're discussing right now, and others are involved in this, is the production of something called a whole farm plan, which will insist that we have things like animal health and welfare built into that as being, if you like, a requirement to be able to attain the support you require. So we have to build in from a statutory base, but then over and above that, we then need to build in standards up and above and over that to ensure that actually what we're producing here in Scotland is recognised as being of the highest and not just doing our best, but to use Pete's phrase about best in class, because that's actually ultimately what will differentiate Scottish produce from produce from the rest of the UK and indeed other parts of the world. So it's in our best interest that we have a baseline standard of regulatory requirement, and I think an awful lot of that's already in place. But then how do you then build that on top of that? And again, animal health and welfare, I think, is compatible with the other objectives of the bill in terms of how do you ensure that we have ruminant livestock systems that are actually underpinning our habitats and grazing and all that sort of thing as well. So there's a connection between all of these things all the time.
Jim.
Thanks, Convener. Just on all of these points that have been made, nobody is going to deny that we absolutely require the best animal health welfare standards. We've already got them. What the farming community do is extensive in making sure the welfare standards are right. But I want to go back to the very first thing that Joe said, and that is what do you define as quality food? It'll be what the customer's prepared to pay for. And I hate to bring money into the issue when we're talking about animal welfare, but ultimately, if you put a £10 steak and a £4 steak in front of a consumer and they're facing a cost of living crisis, they're going to buy the £4 steak, by and large. They do the same thing with milk. We've had programmes where you've got 10p extra going to the farmer, where they had a litre of milk at £1.20 or a litre of milk at £1.30, and they bought the £1.20 before they bought the £1.30. And that's not to put a barrier in the way. That's just how do we find that answer for people who are cash-strapped as it is to say, yeah, all of these other things are really important and I'm prepared to pay for that out of my pocket. And it's, I don't know how you do that in the face of a bill, and if anyone's got any answers, I'd be delighted to hear it.
Leslie.
Thank you. I was just going to say Pete will probably be in a better position to answer this from a Scottish perspective, but I did want to bring to bear the work that the Food, Farming and Countryside Commission have done recently, which has been an extensive amount of citizen engagement and polling, looking at what people want from their food systems. So this is from the ground up, and it has been designed to be broad and representative across a range of different regions. The key finding there, in answer to your very important point here, was that everybody wants good quality food. Everybody wants food that is produced sustainably and delivers healthy outcomes. But there is a barrier to those who are poorer to being able to achieve that, which says something about market failure, and it says something about the food system, not about whether people will make different choices in terms of what they will spend their money on versus what they actually want to buy. They're shut out. I was just going to say, they're shut. So what we're hearing from them is that they want, and this is very much within the UK context as well, particularly looking towards the UK's next election. Mm. What they are saying, those citizens, is that they want the structures in place and the leadership and the infrastructure and the design that will enable them to be able to make those choices. And the unfortunate situation we have coming, dare I say, from the UK and from England specifically, is that we have a fundamental market failure where people can't afford to buy food and farmers can't afford to produce it.
Can I just follow up on that point? I think you're absolutely right in everything that you're saying. Pete, I know that you've done extensive work on this. So how do we get those higher costs that are absolutely part of producing the kind of food that we want to produce affordable for the people who, at the moment, want to buy it?
I'm going to bring in David first and then Pete.
Sure, not a direct answer to Jim's question, but second question. But so I represent food and drink manufacturers, so we buy primary produce and make things out of it. And I think that's so picking up on the commercial side of things. I mean, large UK food and drink manufacturers and Scottish food and drink manufacturers are here because we have high quality food and high quality primary produce that they want to process and manufacture into products here in Scotland, whether that's in the dairy fields of the southwest, whether that's in the oat production we have. So they recognise and invest in production facilities where they can get the best quality agricultural produce, and they come to Scotland for that. And there are multiple companies that have done that. What they're looking for from agricultural in Scotland is a few things, and this is how they would probably define high quality food. And a lot of this aligns with what Joe has said, but Joe is talking about the direct, the end consumer, and I'm talking about the manufacturer in the middle. And what they want is resilient agriculture. Agriculture that can be relied upon, and that's really, really important to them. If they're going to build a massive factory here, they need to make sure that they can get the raw materials and get it regularly to the spec that they need it to be. They want it to be productive so they can get as much as they need from Scotland, and to save it having to come in to Scotland or the UK from other parts of the world. And they also need it to meet all the criteria that they will increasingly need to meet over the years. And that's, I think, where some may be rushing to a definition of high quality or trying to be too prescriptive in a definition of high quality. And I think there are things you can do that aren't prescriptive here. Is one of the problems. As Sarah has already said, if we're thinking about the responsibilities that companies and farmers will have around net zero, we don't actually know really what those will be yet in a form that is sensible, workable commercially, and able to deliver for as low cost as possible some of the things that we want to do. So that's, I guess, why there's a bit of nervousness, and we would have a little bit of nervousness about being too prescriptive on the face of the Act, because it's stuck in law and it becomes much harder to change. So I think there are things that you can do to expand the definition, but I think when you begin to get prescriptive, then you reduce the flexibility of the government to respond to changing circumstances, and you reduce to an extent the flexibility of the Parliament to be able to reflect that in the work that they're doing.
Can I make one very quick point to David?
Very quick.
Yeah, it's very quick. You talked about the long-term investment to actually want to be here.
Yeah.
That's going to require critical mass to make sure long-term production stays in place. Thank you.
Yes, it does.
We've got Pete and then Jenny, and then we're going to move on.
Just briefly, so obviously the bill can't solve
income inequalities in Scotland. I agree with Leslie. All the work we've done suggests people value the same things pretty much. It's just you can't always afford them. So, but I think it's really important to pick up Sarah's point. You know, high animal welfare is not a cost to farmers. It's a benefit to farmers. They can produce more efficiently at a lower price if they look after animals better, you know, in general terms. But the job of government is to raise standards here so that everybody, when they're buying food, knows that it's been produced with happy, healthy animals. You know, and that's government's job is to raise those standards. Just like we don't let people sell sofas that burn, even if they'd be cheap. Right, so we've got to keep raising those minimum standards, and Johnny said keep pushing towards the high end, keep moving that graph along so the best producers are the best in class, and that does mean investment in advice, it means investment in CPD, it means investment in kit, it means investment in helping farmers change their systems so that, you know, we'll never completely narrow the gap between the best and the average. But we can narrow that, and we can make sure that even the average, even the lowest priced food on our shelves, has been produced without animal suffering.
No, I'm going to move. We're already. We need to focus a little bit more. Can I have Jenny, and then Tim indicate you wanted to come in.
Hi, I'm Jenny McDermid, and just to say, my background is in sustainability, nutrition, and food systems. So reading the bill, there is a mention of nutritious food. It's not really sort of in any detail, and I think nutrition needs to be in there because we want to produce food that will lead to healthy outcomes. We know we've got huge health inequalities, and I think that needs to be taken forward. I agree with the cost of living crisis. We need to be sure that what is being produced is actually affordable and we don't end up with a much higher quality inequalities. And I guess one of my questions maybe when we're talking about high quality food is at what stage in the food chain do you define nutritionally high quality? Because you can produce something that at the farm gate is very nutritious, but by the time it's gone through all the processing, it's less nutritious. And I think that was one of my questions sort of to you in terms of the bill, is at what point do you want to define good quality, particularly around the nutrition? Because it can change across the whole of the bill. Across the food chain. And I think this is where it's maybe going wider, but I think it's really important to think about the whole food system and where it fits in, because you end up with unintended consequences if you don't think about it in that sort of steps. I wanted to just pick up on everybody wants certain types of food, high quality, etc. Actually, the research shows that price is obviously is the most important thing. Taste, preference, enjoyability are next, and then you find health and environment tend to be lower down the chain. So I think, again, in talking about health, high quality food, we need to consider these things that actually people will want high quality, but it's maybe not at the very top of their list. And then you've got this conflict between price and production costs. And as I say, one of the big things is not increasing health inequalities. So I think while not being prescriptive, I think needs to be really clear what is the framework for this. You said earlier that there are going to be trade-offs. That's what you get with any food system. When you start to bring all of these things together, whether it's climate, nutrition, etc., you are having to look at, you know, what is the balance between these things. I would prefer to use the word balance rather than trade-off, because trade-off suggests you've got to get rid of something. So what is the balance? So I think you need all of these things as central to the bill, and particularly nutrition, because nutrition is, you know, predominantly sat in other bills in terms of health, a good food nation, etc. And I think there has to be a recognition of how do you go from the agricultural bill to the health bill. So that's my feeling. I would like to see a bit more about what you mean by nutrition. Nutrition's difficult in the sense that, as I said previously, at the farm gate it might be different to what ends up on the plate. There are certain nutrients that you could focus on, but also it's got to be how does it fit into the whole diet, what people are eating, where does it sit within that, because it isn't just a single entity.
Thank you. Briefly, Tim.
Yeah, no, that's fine. We always strive for optimal animal welfare, and we've got to look at mechanisms to make that happen. And certainly the rural support plan and priorities within that could be a good way of doing that. But I suppose from a purely practical example, we've talked about sectors sort of historically being high intensive, that for an agricultural bill talking about rural support programmes, a lot of those sectors fall out with the scope of the bill in terms of providing financial support. So, you know, egg producers, poultry producers generally have not had access to that support previously and won't be from here. So we need to consider about what's in the scope of the bill and levers to do that. And from the flip side of it, the market is actually driving quite a lot of that already. And within the egg sector, within the poultry sector and in the pig sector, you're seeing a lot of standards expected of producers that are greater than what legislation and regulations need anyway. So.
We're now going to move on to look at some of the other objectives of the agricultural policy. Kate Forbes.
Thanks very much. And convener, we'll be coming back to rural payments, won't we, anyway, later on. So thank you very much. My question is really about some of the other objectives. So this is obviously a bill that's entitled Agricultural and Rural Communities. We've clearly focused quite extensively on a number of objectives, some of which are already in the bill and some of which are not so far. But I have two questions, if that's okay. The first is around the rural communities thriving point. And Johnny, you quoted the Cabinet Secretary as saying that there was no inherent tension between all the various objectives in terms of biodiversity, climate change, and so on. But when we look specifically at enabling rural communities to thrive, do you see any inherent tension between the objectives that are there already and rural communities thriving, or maybe not? And secondly, and this is a specific question that I'd really value a specific answer to, inevitably in a roundtable like this, everybody will have ideas about the additional objectives that we need to add. If you have too many, you actually don't have a very focused bill. What do you think is the optimum number of objectives? Is four right? Is it too many, too few? So those are my two questions. Thank you.
Thanks. That seems to be aimed at me a wee bit.
Well, just
I'm quite happy.
Intentions.
I'll be very candid about this. So when the bill was published on the 29th of September and it had agriculture and rural communities written on it, that obviously raised a few eyebrows because we'd anticipated it being an agriculture bill. But actually the title Agriculture and Rural Communities, I think, is absolutely right to include rural communities in that, because it underlines the fact that if we support agriculture to deliver on food, climate and biodiversity, and we're focusing on active farming and crofting, then that absolutely underpins what we've argued for a long time, that the value of that support doesn't just go into farms and crofts, it actually permeates throughout rural communities, and that's absolutely critical. Particularly as you get into more remote parts of Scotland, our less favoured areas in particular. And one of the key objectives of this bill must be to sustain active farming and crofting in those areas in order to underpin the socio-economic dimension of what happens in rural Scotland. It's always been a key aspect of agricultural policy through the CAP, and obviously it's been sort of utilised in the Scottish context to very good effect, using the tools at our disposal. But now I think it's really important that we fundamentally ensure that the rural communities aspect is front and centre alongside climate and biodiversity and food production. The multiplier effects, if you like, upstream, think of all the tens of hundreds and then tens of thousands of jobs and incomes and livelihoods that are dependent upon farming and crofting upstream in our rural areas. And then obviously what then leaves the farm gate in terms of underpinning jobs in all sorts of communities in terms of our agri-food sectors. It's a linchpin, if you like, farming and crofting, in terms of what it does in a socio-economic context as much as anything else. So I have no difficulty whatsoever in rural communities being sitting alongside agriculture. The key will be ensuring that that support underpins active farming and crofting, and I'm quite specific about that, not just production, but active land management that builds resilience, has a flourishing and thriving environment, and on the back of that, you get thriving rural communities. If you don't, you certainly start to see decline in rural populations in certain locations. You see decline in rural services in certain regions as well. And that's something we absolutely need to avoid. And this particular piece of legislation can and will provide the means to ensure some of that. So 100% support for rural communities being in there.
A number of objectives?
Number of objectives, I think is right. We've been quite clear for some time that we've got it's been put in front of us as an agricultural industry, as an agricultural community, that we have challenges around climate, we have challenges around biodiversity, and we certainly have challenges around ensuring the sustainability of our rural communities. So with agriculture being at the heart of all that in terms of farming and crofting, and farmers and crofters being uniquely placed to deliver on those things, I think linking food production, that inherent aspect of what agriculture is all about, with the delivery of these other objectives that are so important in the national interest, not just in agriculture's interest, then I think linking food, climate, biodiversity and people is absolutely right.
Thank you.
David.
Yeah, thank you. I'm to clear our history here, because as a civil servant, I used to be responsible for both food processing, marketing and collaboration grants and the LEADER programme once upon a while. So both of these were the grant programmes that sat underneath the Common Agricultural Policy to support both food processing and communities. I won't talk about communities because that's nothing to do with my current job. However, the reason that we've got these objectives in this bill is because it's a direct replacement for the framework that sat under Europe. And I think you could absolutely argue that each of them should have been potentially treated separately, but that's not where we are. And so, you know, from our perspective, one of the key elements here is, you know, the element to support food and drink production and processing in Schedule 1, 4, and that is, you know, a way to allow the government to support small and medium-sized food and drink processors to make the best use of Scottish high-quality food. And so for us, that's a really, really important part. And if that wasn't part of this bill, then we would absolutely be seeking another mechanism in which the Scottish ministers could support those elements. And that's one of the reasons why, when we were talking about the definition of high-quality food and drink, and in response to Jenny's point about where nutrition is considered, if you use a definition of nutrition that says a biscuit is not available for support here, then you're going to cut out quite a lot of Scotland's high-quality small and medium-sized enterprises from using Scottish produce, because if you're aiming for nutritional benefits for everything you do, then you're going to lose that flexibility to do that for a small biscuit producer, for example.
Okay, thank you. Joe.
Yeah, just to echo what Johnny said around rural communities, I think from our point of view as Scotland Food and Drink, we're interested in quite a holistic view across the landscape. We're also interested in looking at how the economic and social and environmental goals can be achieved. And the social bit is very much bound up in how does good food that's grown, produced in Scotland, serve the communities within which it is produced. And having rural communities as a headline is probably no bad thing to get that achieved. And certainly we see that in, for example, as CAP is evolving, even in 23 to 27 plans, each of those plans that are produced by member states, the strategic plans, reference the rural communities that agriculture serves. And I think that's a foundation that underpins a lot of agricultural support and policy around certainly Europe. And it doesn't hurt to have that front and centre, I don't think, from our perspective at all. And just in terms of the objectives, I think the only one, the number's sort of less relevant than what each of those delivers. And the only one that we feel could have been potentially added or included is around that value, and we see the EU recognising that, the value in the supply chain, the value at the production end, value for farmers and growers, which could have been potentially included.
Back again, because I think there was a really useful point that actually threaded together quite a lot of the discussion this morning, and that comes back to rural communities and critical mass, particularly of livestock production. So I come representing Quality Meat Scotland here. In terms of a supply chain, we're worth about £2.8 billion to the Scottish economy. £839 million of that is gross value added. And activity within our supply chain will be taking place in every single parish across Scotland. You know, there isn't a parish that doesn't have crofting, farming, manufacturing. And I think that's really important as a driver of the wider economy. When we start to see that wider supply chain, because we are very interlinked in red meat in terms of producer going through to consumer and that wider value chain. We spoke about animal welfare earlier. One of the biggest challenges that we are seeing just now in terms of being able to deliver sustained positive animal welfare is availability of vets in some of those, you know, the Highlands and Islands in there. So, and that's where that critical mass of livestock production, if you don't maintain a critical mass of livestock production, some of the other objectives that we want to focus on become very difficult to deliver. And that then, you know, so you, in the heart of all that, you have businesses, crofting businesses, farming businesses, that if they don't have the support that enable them to, you know, provide high quality food and high animal welfare outcomes, they don't have vets, they don't have, you know, the other support mechanisms, being able to reach them in parts of the country because there aren't enough livestock to maintain a service, that business will potentially then disappear. That happens again and again and again. Then suddenly you find that you have parts of the country with no agricultural production and we don't have enough critical mass to then sustain the businesses downstream, which are a critical part of our manufacturing sector in terms of the wider economy. So I think I just wanted, you know, to highlight that. You know, it's really, really difficult sometimes to bring it to life, what it is we're actually talking about. But, you know, that is how little things, and particularly in our livestock value chain, not having the critical mass of whether it's beef, sheep, cattle, pigs, what, you know, whatever we're talking about, we need to have a critical mass of numbers that enables us to deliver these services, to enjoy and make the most of that really, really strong value chain.
Thank you for that. From our point of view, we were absolutely delighted to see that Agriculture and Rural Communities Bill was its title. You know, I think for too long there's been that element that is almost perceived as an either-or. You know, at the end of the day, farming, agriculture is at the beating hearts of rural communities, just as fishing, etc., are, you know, from a maritime communities. So that was, you know, as I say, we're delighted on that front. I mean, from our point of view, you know, representing all the agricultural co-ops in Scotland, I mean, there's multiple co-ops in every constituency represented around this table, and they're all rural employers. The, you know, the farmer-owned businesses that are employing people in those communities. And that kind of then, you know, brings on to the fifth objective, which you'll no doubt be aware of through our consultation feedback. The kind of the elephant in the room, from my point of view, is that we won't get high-quality food production, we can't have sustainable agriculture, we won't get climate-mitigated, nature-restored agriculture, and we won't have rural communities if we don't have viable farming. And if we don't have resilient farming, you know, and that becomes, that is the missing, that's the elephant in the room from my point of view in terms of, our point of view in terms of a fifth objective. And a kind of a, you know, we've heard Jim talking about critical mass. We've talked, David, about the needs of manufacturers to have resilient agriculture, resilient production base. If that's not an overarching objective of the bill, then everything else potentially can become worthless. And, you know, faced with a reality of an environment where there is unlikely to be more public support, more direct support for farming, then farming is going to have to rely more on the market to, for its returns, become viable, to remain viable. Unless we have that as an objective in the bill, unless that becomes one of the key, one of the fifth driver within rural support plans, then everything else potentially is worthless.
So can I ask, should there be other objectives in the face of the bill? You've talked about a fifth. We've only got four, but the Common Agricultural Policy has 10. Should we see more objectives on the face of the bill?
From our point of view, the one about the viability, the profitability of farming becomes the key underpinner. We have no other asks beyond that. I can see that there's a risk that it becomes all things to all people, and you lose focus. But certainly that would be our ask around a fifth one, to help support success of all the others.
Okay. Johnny.
I'll just echo what Tim's just said about the, you know, and I hope I conveyed that in my response to Kate, in that you have to have viable, sustainable, and I'll use the word profitable, agricultural businesses of all sizes and types and shapes in every quarter of Scotland if you're going to underpin that socio-economic aspect, which is so important, and then be able to deliver on climate and biodiversity. But to answer the convener's question around should we have more objectives on the face of the bill, I think this bill doesn't sit in isolation. It is part of a collection of policy objectives through other pieces of legislation and strategies that the Scottish Government is pursuing. We know there will be a land reform bill coming forward in the early part of next year. In the next parliamentary session, we know there'll be a natural environment bill to deliver on the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy. So lots of other pieces of existing and forthcoming legislation mapping out what the Scottish Government is trying to achieve across not only rural Scotland but across Scotland.
That's all very well, but we've got an agricultural bill in front of us. Is there any indication within the bill, as is drafted at the moment, that that's going to be the case? So all the things that you aspire to and you suggest are going to be delivered, where in the bill does it actually suggest that's going to happen? Do we just have to rely on the government coming forward with central legislation that fulfils all your ambitions? Because in the face of the bill, I don't see these things that you're describing at the moment. I don't see a link to land reform. I don't see a link to biodiversity plan. I don't see a link to climate change plan. So where do you get your confidence that this bill is actually going to deliver everything that you aspire it to deliver?
Because this will be the vehicle to deliver the outcomes we want, because the secondary legislation that will follow from the agriculture bill will be tasked with delivering on existing targets around climate and forthcoming targets around biodiversity, and certainly around how do we underpin our rural communities. So I see this bill, and we've used the phrase often, as doing the heavy lifting. It's that piece that how do you transpose the powers that will be in the bill into actions and deliverables in terms of that secondary legislation. That's the key question, but that's not in the bill. That's what will have to come next. What we need in the bill is broad-ranging powers that we can then adapt and utilise to deliver the outcomes we want. And at the moment, if you look at part two of the bill, I think there's sufficient scope, flexibility and necessity within the powers to support activities and outcomes in that section of the bill.
Okay, thank you. Pete.
There's a general point. There's a tension in this discussion and in the bill about whether basically in Scotland we're pretty much good enough or whether we need to change quite a lot. And I think that's at the heart of this conversation. I don't think we're good enough, not just in terms of our obligations on climate and nature, but also on what the market is increasingly going to be wanting us to deliver. We have to make some pretty significant changes, and telling ourselves we're doing well is not enough. So that's a general point, but I wanted to respond to Kate's points about the rural communities bit in the bill. I think rural communities are shortchanged by this bill. I think it is very much, as Johnny said, a bit of an afterthought. We were surprised to see that on the bill. When you look into the bill, there's actually very little about rural communities. There's not even a commitment to spending 5% of the budget on LEADER, which is a CAP commitment. You know, and LEADER was one of the best things about the CAP, to be quite honest, because it got local people involved, working together, adding value to farm produce, generating local food economies, doing useful things in their communities. And we'd like to see that reinstated in as a commitment to that local community-led development. And we'd also like to see that extended to urban authorities. Just down the road here, we've got Lauriston Farm, 130 acres of urban farm. So rural isn't agriculture, and agriculture isn't rural. So I think every local authority should be getting some money from this to be able to support what Joe talked about, the short food chains, the community growing, making food something which is accessible to more people, not just something which happens in rural areas. We need a big glasshouse sector in Scotland. There's lots of things we could be doing, local authority-led local development, community-led local development, that actually enhances our food sector. So I think, but if we look at the bill, there are lots of other things that rural communities need which are not addressed in the bill. And it may be that they're addressed in other legislation, but the problems of rural communities or the challenges for rural communities aren't going to be sorted out just by this bill. And there's a danger that we think rural done because we've put it in the agriculture bill. On your objectives, I would commend the Wales Agriculture Bill, not all of it, but significant elements of it, because it sets out four high-level objectives on the face of the bill: food, nature, climate, and helping rural communities, including the Welsh language and culture and landscapes. And it then has 15 sort of objectives further down the track. But the nice thing about it is that it requires government to come forward with targets and indicators on those objectives, on those 15 things. What do we mean by those things, whether it's high-quality food or animal welfare or whatever? And they have to take advice when they're doing that, including from the Future Generations Commissioner in Wales, and they have to come back to Parliament and say, here's our plan. And they have a date on the face of the bill as to when they have to do that by. And they also have a date on the face of the bill as to when they need to produce their equivalent of the rural support plan, with budget envelopes, with, you know, uptake estimates, and with estimates of how well this is going to deliver on the objectives right on the face of the bill. So it's a much more joined-up approach to holding government accountable to what Parliament and people want our agriculture system to look like.
OK, I'm going to bring in Rhoda Grant, where we kick off on the theme and the Code of Practice for Sustainable and Regenerative Agriculture. Rhoda.
Yes, and I fear this conversation is going to be a wee bit like the last one, in that some people are responding, telling us that they want to know what that means on the face of the bill. They need to know what to expect. And others are saying, no, leave it for the Code of Conduct, because that changes with time. And I suppose secondary to that is the scrutiny of the Code of Conduct in the bill correct? Is that the right level of scrutiny?
Who'd like to kick off? Johnny.
Yeah, I'm happy to pick that up. Obviously, the bill in Part 4 sets out the requirement to produce a Code of Practice for Sustainable and Regenerative Agriculture. And we have absolutely no difficulty with that whatsoever, given that the vision for Scottish agriculture is to be a world leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture. The obvious question that has been raised is it's not defined in the bill, but the bill does require ministers to come up with a code of practice through consultation and through consideration of what that might mean and how does it work in practice. Because clearly that code of practice for sustainable and regenerative agriculture will be one of the tests, if you like, maybe test not the right word, for how we distribute support and people become eligible support, because they will have to adhere to that code of practice. And again, no difficulty whatsoever. I would have significant difficulty if we tried to, again, define it very hardly, very tightly on the face of the bill. I was in the European Commission talking to DG Agri in October about this very issue of regenerative agriculture, and officials from the European Commission seriously advised not to try and define regenerative agriculture. It's more a set of principles than anything else, and their advice was don't define it tightly, because then it becomes something, again, that might box us in terms of how we adapt, how we develop. Because all codes of practice need to be able to be flexible, adaptable, and changeable over time. So I think it's going to be a really important aspect of what happens beyond the bill, the creation of that code of practice, how that's consulted upon, what does that mean, how is it then deployed, in how do we allocate support. It needs to be a litmus test, if you like, for how we do that. But having it defined tightly on the face of the bill, I don't think is what's required at this stage.
You've got Sarah and then Pete.
Yeah, so I just wanted to come in specifically on the regenerative farming term, and it fresh off the plane from COP28 just on Monday. This was the word of the conference over the last few days, and interestingly this morning with the latest global stocktake text, there is now specific reference to regenerative farming coming out of the high-level COP28 negotiations. So there's a clear level of alignment there in terms of global policy filtering down here into Scotland. I think the one thing, you know, we've spoken about how important it is to define regenerative farming. I do think it is important that we as a supply chain, as an industry, do define what regenerative farming means to Scotland, because what's right for Scotland is very different to other types of what other people are talking about in terms of regenerative farming. And I think, you know, again, going back to that principle of co-design with industry, there's a big opportunity there to do that, have that conversation and make sure that there is a really strong definition of regenerative farming that we can own, that we can then build through our rural support plans, that we can then enable producers to embed into their farming practices, you know, coming back into Pete's point about, you know, enabling the production systems we want to see. And then most importantly, again, how do we link that to the marketplace? That's what QMS do in terms of providing that brand. We can then link that brand to the marketplace to make sure that consumers are given the opportunity to invest in food that is investing in the supply chains and the producers that they want to see. And I think so getting that definition right for Scotland, I think, is really, really important. And again, I go back to something I said earlier. Scotland is a broad church. What's right in one part of the country isn't going to be right in another. So we do need to make sure that we enable producers at the heart of communities. You know, we spoke about communities earlier, are enabled to produce the right products in the right place. And I think that's a really, really important moment to announce that.
So where is it defined, given it's so important for the future? Where is sustainable and regenerative actually defined to give that clarity?
I mean, there are a number of different definitions that you can find from a number of different organisations. And like I say, I ask this question quite regularly at any conference, event, seminar I go to, you know, but have we been good enough? And I think that's where it's important that we define it for Scotland rather than picking something. You know, it's important that it has to be a Scottish definition that works for the Scottish context and Scottish businesses.
But where should it be? So it's named on the face of this bill as an overarching objective. So where do we actually do it? Who does it? And where does it sit?
So I would say that it has to be that co-design between businesses and government. You know, going back to that co-design principle, it is right that we involve businesses who are going to deliver in the design of that, whether it sits within that rural support plan or on the face of the bill. I'm actually probably wouldn't want to give an answer on what's right to do that. I think the core principle of making sure that businesses who are delivering it are involved in the definition of it is the important one.
Pete.
Implicit in part four of the bill about the code of practice around sustainable and regenerative agriculture, that it isn't given in the bill, but if the elements within that section of the bill talk about engagement with the sector and so on. I would just emphasise Sarah's point further, let alone doing it for Scottish context, actually even within Scottish, what would be regenerative agriculture for our soft fruit sector is going to be very different from what will be for our extensive hill farming sector on the West Coast. Different aspects of regenerative in play there. So that's why we need a code of practice rather than a hard and fast definition.
Okay. Can I bring Pete in and I'll bring you in, Jim?
It's given a lot of prominence in the bill, and the question is why? Because if it's just a nice-to-have bit of advice for farmers, here's some good things to do, we don't need it in the bill. We can have that from the advisory services. So if it's in the bill, it must have some legal power. It must do something. And the question is it, as Johnny says, to be used as a ticket or, I can't remember the exact word, but some sort of, you know, entry point to either Tier 2 payments or Tier 1 payments that you comply with the code, just like you have to comply with the Muleburn code. You have to comply with this code if you're doing business in Scotland farming. And so the question, I think, for the committee is, what work is this code doing in the bill and in the holding government and, you know, moving the objectives forward? Because if it's not got any legal impact or impact on how much money farmers get, there's really no point in having it in the bill. It might be nice to have, but it's not going to do anything. And then your point about how you draw it up is going to be really difficult. Sarah's absolutely right. You know, I love eggs. I had eggs for breakfast. It's really hard to think how a poultry farmer can show if they're importing soya and it's not IP soya or it's not guarantee free from deforestation. How can they show that they're doing regenerative agriculture? It's really hard for them, but we need eggs. You know, so I think we have to be really careful about defining something that excludes some people from support that we want to support. So and I think we should take our time about this. If it's important, make it part of the tier system eventually, but take our time to do this, involve a lot of people in it so that we're really moving forward together. But as David will say, I mean, the supply chain loves regenerative agriculture because it covers so many different things. And as we keep having to come back to, a lot of the heavy lifting is going to be done by the supply chain in the next few years. And what government has to do is to be ahead of that and look at what are the perverse consequences of that, what are the potential consequences for small producers, for marginal producers, producers that don't have the money to invest in change. You know, how can government make sure that the impact of the market is beneficial to all farmers and crofters, not just to some?
Thank you. Jim?
It's just a minor point that when we're talking about how we define it, I was looking at the 1946 Hill Sheep Farming Act to discover things about Muirburn recently. The 1946 Sheep Hill Farming Act prescribed that only specific types of tups could be used as defined by the minister. How many ministers know what a good hill tup looks like and what it should, what its function should be? So it's there is a danger here that if we be very prescriptive, that we send farming into a particular direction. So surely we've got to look at something that is allowing ministers to let the industry develop into the objectives that the bill has.
I would argue that's what is set out in part four of the bill, and it talks about a code of practice. It doesn't say we will have a definition of sustainable regenerative agriculture. It's about developing a code of practice, and then it outlines how that implicitly how that needs to be brought about by the points that Sarah's made, Pete's made, about it being a co-designed approach to ensure that it actually fits with different farming systems, different contexts. Scottish agriculture is remarkably diverse, as you know, and we need to ensure that whether you're crofting on the West Coast or you're operating a large arable unit in Berwickshire, that it's equally applicable, but to the context in which you find yourself.
So my question is, why does it not just say the adoption of a code of practice rather than actually say the adoption and use of sustainable and regenerative agricultural as one of the objectives?
Well, I would argue that Scottish Government would probably argue that because that's the vision for Scottish agriculture is to be a world leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture, and that's in black and white, and that's clearly as part of the agricultural reform route map that they've published over the last 18 months, then that would be the link into that.
And just with the parliamentary process, should that code of practice come before the committee to scrutinise before it comes into action, if you like, before it's activated?
I would argue a bit that the point that Pete's made I would endorse is that if it's of any worth or value and it's going to be used as some sort of leverage either to access support payments or as, if you like, the baseline of what we would regard as not only good practice but getting to the best in class piece that we want to get to, then I would have thought if it's got that legal status, that influence, then I would have thought this committee has to have some sort of scrutiny over it. But that, again, will come further down the track in secondary legislation.
Well, not necessarily. If this committee is going to have a role to scrutinise code of practice and future farm plans, there is a suggestion that the government has to bring forward a plan and it will consult on that, but there is nothing within the bill that suggests that this committee or Parliament has any role. So are you suggesting that on the face of the bill there should be an obligation for that code of conduct or practice or the future plan to come before Parliament?
I certainly think if it's part of the conditionality of receipt of payment, then it should be.
Thank you. Joe?
It's just to say a lot of the debate around this particular question seems to be process-based. And I think from Scotland Food and Drinks' perspective, we're really concerned with the outcome and what we are achieving. And at some point, we will have to define these terms. We'll have to understand what they mean, and we'll have to assess and measure whether or not they're being implemented across all the different sectors, all the geographical areas. And in order to do that, the process is less relevant than that it is achieved. So we don't necessarily have a strong view about upfront, but I guess the people who are saying it should be upfront are probably the people who are concerned about it being watered down or having less scrutiny on the bits that come subsequent to that. But as Johnny's touched on, that needn't be the case. If these plans are there to be measured, if the objectives are there to be reviewed and the processes are in place to review them, and it's vital that they are, because brand and reputation of Scottish food and drink is the thing that underpins our ability to sell it to the world and is the thing that will allow us to sustain Scotland through our strategic objectives of sustaining Scotland supplying the world. So we have to get it right, but I don't know that it's absolutely critical that we get it right now versus through the other mechanisms down the line.
Yeah, thank you. David?
Just a small point, I think, in terms of the commercial side of things. So lots and lots and lots of people who buy primary produce have specifications and audit and assurance that will be well above, I would imagine, anything that can necessarily be put in the place of a code of practice. So that's the, you know, in that commercial reality, you know, farmers and producers are dealing with those independent audits and independent codes of practice in order to supply Tesco or in order to supply a manufacturer. In any case, so I think, you know, some of the points that Pete's made in terms of actually where's the market failure, what's the where are the things that the Scottish Government needs to step in and support, and the Scottish Parliament needs to have an eye on are the critical elements of this from our perspective, because the danger is that you set standards that are not commercially viable.
Thank you, Rhoda.
Yeah, I just want to make it clear to people that the code of practice will be subject to the negative procedure, which is the government devise a code of practice. They can consult on it, but it comes to the Parliament as lead. If we don't like it in the Parliament, we have to put forward a motion to annul. That falls. Now, my understanding, because this is part of the objectives of the bill, that the whole funding of farming depends on this code of practice being in place. So that means that it will be very difficult for a committee to annul, given that that might delay farming support. There are other procedures. You can have an affirmative procedure, which means it's laid and the Parliament have to vote for it, but again, it's a take it or leave it. And in other pieces of legislation, they've had what we term a super affirmative, where a draft is laid in front of the Parliament, the committee scrutinise it, put comments back to the government, and then the government come forward, taking or maybe not taking the comments of the committee on board, and then we vote on it. So those are the different tests, I guess. And I suppose what I'm asking you is the negative process, which is a move to annul, sufficient for anything on which farming payments depend? Should we be looking at super affirmative for parts of the legislation and codes that are coming through subordinate legislation? Should we be looking at that if farming payments depend on them?
Tim, once again, for a bit of clarification, the Scottish ministers may make regulations about guidance, but the guidance itself actually doesn't come under any parliamentary scrutiny. So we've got to be clear there's the two different things here. Tim, and then John.
I think just in terms of what Rhoda's talked about, then I'll sort of reinforce where I was going to endorse what Pete was saying. You know, just in terms of, you know, the purpose. What is the purpose of the code and how is it going to be deployed? And if Johnny says it is something that may get linked to conditional support, and that should be clearer in the bill, and come back to your point, Rhoda, then that's something that there should be a more affirmative process behind it. Now, if it's not, if it's aspirational, then that's less of an issue. But then if it's aspirational, to come back to Pete's point, what's the point? So what?
Yeah, I think we've got to be clear. Again, I've said this before, this is the business end of the bill. We can talk about aspirations, but if it's not on the face of the bill, how we can ensure our aspirations are realised, there's little point in talking about it. Johnny, can I bring Johnny and then Leslie? I'm sorry.
Because that point of view can maybe go unchallenged. I mean, we have heard that, you know, it's quite useful to put many of these things in secondary rather than primary legislation. So that point isn't a statement that would go unchallenged.
No, it's my opinion. Thanks, Alistair. Johnny and then Leslie.
Yeah, I mean, if you look throughout the bill, I mean, this, as we all know, is a framework bill, primary legislation. So much of this is about creating powers, and about how those powers are then used will all come through secondary legislation. And therefore, throughout the bill, particularly in part two, which is all about the support payments aspects, there's a whole raft of clauses talking about either affirmative or negative procedures. And the one thing I would say is that clearly, we need scrutiny, because there is no counterbalance in terms of what the Scottish Government might pursue. This committee and this Parliament are the means to scrutinise the secondary legislation. It's the checks and balances piece.
So where on the primary legislation is there anything to suggest what the role of Parliament is in some of these really important aspects like guidance and code of practice?
But if you look at all the support elements, the types of support that might be created by the powers, particularly in part two, as well as and that's the key bit for me, is the part two piece. All of that is underwritten in subclauses, or whatever they're called, about being subject to affirmative or negative approval. And that takes me back to Rhoda's point. You could argue quite strongly that you need to ensure that it's not just a situation whereby things have to pass in order to stop, in order to prevent things being stopped or delayed and things like that. So we would want to see proper and full scrutiny of the secondary legislation, but that comes with secondary legislation. So the key point for me would be to ensure that there's amendments in the bill as drafted at stage two to ensure that those checks and balances are in place.
That was exactly my point.
Not to say what the secondary legislation should be,
no.
But to say that when the secondary legislation comes forward, it is subject to the affirmative, if that's the better approach, or even, the super affirmative, yeah, to ensure that there is a proper check and balance. But that's not saying that what's actually in the bill itself is how those powers should be used. That's got to come in the secondary legislation. The scrutiny bit has to be in the secondary, the scrutiny bit has to be in the primary legislation, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it absolutely does, and it kind of leads on to it's how those code of conducts and practice and whatever are measured, monitored and evaluated. That's unclear on the face of the bill at the moment. It needs to be in primary to ensure the secondary legislation is monitored and evaluated. Leslie, and then I think Pete.
I think specifically to this point, the question that I'm asking myself is, what are the mechanisms that need to be in the framework that will enable it to deliver those outcomes? And so, for example, is there something here that needs to ensure that value chains are fair and viable, et cetera, et cetera? So what are the things that you need? Equally, what do you need in terms of requiring the code of practice and requiring the mechanisms that will deliver the bill and deliver these outcomes to actually measure and monitor outcomes across those holistic requirements? In terms of the definition of regenerative agriculture, it feels very strange to be creating a bill that's about sustainable and regenerative agriculture without a definition, or at least a set of key outcomes and deliverables that it is going to achieve. And that might be in your objectives, but this is a thing that has no formal recognition anywhere in the world at all. The closest you will get to it is the FAO's definition of agroecology, which some people, are allergic to, but it basically says the same things, that people and incomes and environment and so on are the key deliverables that you want. So I wonder if there is something to Pete's point around having those objectives and outcomes that the bill will achieve up front that says that are effectively your definition of the things that your new regenerative and sustainable agriculture system will achieve. Otherwise, I just think you leave potentially Scottish farming flapping in the wind with anyone being able to push it in a different direction. And certainly to that point of scrutiny, if this is the future of Scottish agriculture, it has to be scrutinised. My one question to the room would be, just to that final point, there are already mechanisms out there that have started to look at what do you need to put in place to deliver and scale regenerative agriculture. So I would simply point towards the Sustainable Markets Initiative's Agribusiness Task Force that delivered a plan for action across finance, markets, food companies and policy. And that was released at COP28, so the Sustainable Markets Initiative. But there are also mechanisms like Regen10, the Global Farm Metric and so on, which have already done a lot of the multi-stakeholder work that would allow you to be able to say, well, how is this relevant to us in Scotland? But my question was going to be about timing. One of the things we have seen in the UK, in England rather, I apologise. One of the things we've seen in England is the kind of kicking the can down the road and the confusion and inertia from farmers to be able to invest in transition because they don't know what they're going to be asked to do. And secondly, that they are being asked to carry the risk for that transition as well. And so I would simply say to you that that surety, that clarity needs to come sooner rather than later for people to know which direction they're going in and whether they're even going to have a viable business. And I particularly speak to the English legislation now, which basically means that once basic payments go, hill farmers have limited or no income because the market doesn't work for them. So people need to know what they are investing in and where they're going. And my concern is that you could end up, potentially, if you have secondary legislation, with years of people not knowing where they're going.
OK. I'm going to bring Pete in, and then I've got supplements from Rachel and Jim.
Yeah. I think we're all agreed this is a framework bill. The bit that's going to translate the framework into action is the rural support plan. And the bill as it stands is very weak on defining the rural support plan. I've already mentioned the Wales bill, which has more definition. We want to see it much more like the CAP strategic plan. We want to stay aligned to the CAP. CAP strategic plan has really clear obligations, what needs to be in that plan. We need budget envelopes. We need uptake estimates. We need estimates of impact of those different measures on climate and nature, but also on food production and farm incomes. We need to look at differential impacts, as Leslie said. You know, at the moment, most of the money goes to the people with the most land on the best land, not to the hill farmers who are struggling. You know, so the rural support plan has to set up all of that. How are we going to translate the broad framework of the bill into how we spend public money to do the best job for Scotland? And Parliament has to look at that rural support plan, and it has to look at it with some time and effort and also ideally external advice, because there's a danger that we just look very parochially. The examples I see you've given are really good of how other places are handling this. You know, we need to look at that in detail because that's the engine of change. And as I said, in the Wales bill, there's a date for when that has to be produced and laid before Parliament. And I think the difficulty for the committee, because we've seen this with other framework bills, is that essentially they leave it to government to make the plan, and then the plan takes a while to come back, and Parliament's moved on to other things. So we have to strengthen this bill, particularly around the rural support plan.
Thank you. A brief supplementary from Rachel and Jim. Excuse me.
It's just back to Leslie Mitchell, please. You're absolutely right, Aran. I believe that it should be about viable farming within the objectives. It talks about thriving rural communities, but it doesn't talk about the viability of farms. We visited a progressive arable unit in the borders, Colin McGregor's place at Coldstream Mains. He described to us what he'd been doing over the years in terms of low tillage, low inputs. He described it as regenerative. But my question would be, if we don't have an objective to ensure that we de-risk farming and ensure there's viable farming units, that actually regenerative means nothing, because all it is some sort of label that allows a government to describe that they want to meet a net zero target. And it doesn't have any meat behind those bones. And I think that is something that we're missing here, because without farmers being sustainable, we cannot meet net zero.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that is the key question, not just around how they continue to be viable in the future, but how do you create the conditions for them to make any transitions that they do need to make. And I think there is one other question around the economic arrangements, which is that for these farmers and these thriving rural communities, if they are to thrive, they are the stewards of that land, and they are also the producers of food. So this is about land sharing, not land sparing, so to speak. But the important point for me there is that we don't want to create a situation where we reward restoration from degradation, but we don't reward the people who have already, to your point, been investing in making this work. But we can't simply leave that to the market. We need to create the conditions for the market to work effectively. Thank you.
I think Joe wants to come in on this briefly.
Yeah, just very quickly, is in CAP strategic plan reference that Pete made. I know we might talk about CAP later, but the CAP strategic plans within each member state come out of a toolkit or a template that they have to follow. And the top line, or one of the first pages of that, talks about the need to protect the people who work in agriculture, because they still earn on average less than other sectors. And that's got to be fundamental to the rural support plan.
Okay, thank you. Jim Fairley.
David, you might want to listen to this one. You're talking about how retailers and the processor are looking for specific requirements from producers to have in their systems. So scope 3 emissions, that's absolutely going to be taken into account as this develops. We've had retailers in here saying that they are prepared and are already doing some retail risk share. So if a farmer gets flooded out and loses 30 acres of tatties or neeps, they'll pick up some of that share. That's not the same across the board. The risk is all in the farmer's plate. So if we're talking about sustainable agriculture, then farmers can't carry all of that load at all times. Is there an appetite in the retailer's mindset to say that we will support agriculture, we need farmers to be there, so therefore we'll take on some of that risk? And if there isn't, should there be something in the bill somewhere that pushes them in that direction?
Speak for retailers directly, thankfully. But yeah, you're right. Each retailer will have a different relationship with its suppliers and, in fact, a different relationship across different sectors, even with the same retailer. So that's part of the issue. And from a manufacturing perspective, manufacturers will be the same. Some of them will have very good and productive relationships with their suppliers and others. It will just be on a more commercial basis than otherwise. I think we've seen what risk sharing looks like over the past few years with the amount of inflation in the supply chain. And I think depending on which element of the supply chain you're talking to, you will get a different answer as to where that risk sharing has been. So retailers will say that they're protecting consumers and paying as well as they can. Manufacturers will say they're getting cut to the bone from both the farmer and the retailer. And farmers will say that they're at the end of the chain and have to deal with all the costs. And I think, you know, there's a bit of truth in all of those things. There's nothing in the bill that puts that risk sharing in place. I think my members would they haven't sanctioned me to say that there would be a desire for risk sharing amongst manufacturers. But yes, I mean, it is a supply chain, and the best relationships and the most productive ones are ones where you know, there's mutual respect and there are standards in place and manufacturers and retailers are supporting their producers. But there's nothing in the bill that guarantees that.
Johnny.
Yeah, just to add, and I agree with Jim's comments about risks and the need for risk sharing to be built in somewhere. Clearly, within the bill, there are powers for Scottish ministers to make payments in extreme circumstances, when, for example, with a flooding situation and a crop gets washed out, whatever that might be. But that's closing the stable door after the horse has bolted, sort of thing, and that's not necessarily the most effective use of taxpayer funding. What we need to build into the whole system through our agricultural policy going forward is more resilience anyway. And I think, you know, Tim touched on that earlier on, and I think we'd all recognise that. Having an element of risk sharing built in terms of the whole supply chain, I think we would support that. But in practice, how would that work? I'm not 100% sure. So it definitely bears thinking about. Because I think going forward, the whole supply chain, if it's going to be a resilient, robust supply chain, we do need to have risk built into it, and the different links within the supply chain share different elements of risk appropriately, rather than all that risk being passed down to the primary producer.
Tim and Sarah.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, I talked about resilience earlier, and following on from Johnny's piece, you know, you obviously expect me to say that, but, you know, certainly supporting producers to cooperate in various guises is a good way to do that. Then, you know, it's good if we get retailer commitments. You know, they might not be comprehensive, they might not be long-lasting, they may float around a bit like in the wind. So, you know, from my point of view, is if you provide the mechanisms I suppose, have it within the objective about increasing the resilience of farming first and foremost, and then in secondary legislation have programmes in place to support producers to cooperate, then that helps producers minimise risk or pool the risk, as it were. And, you know, we saw a good example of sort of 4 or 5 years ago. There's a group of Ware potato growers in the kind of east of Scotland who had one customer. And that customer relationship had worked well for quite a number of years. And then over 2 or 3 years, they were put under severe challenge in terms of pricing. And then actually they just said, well, we're actually taking away a third of your tonnage. So they had the complete rug pulled from underneath them. And though, to the credit of those producers, they ended up saying, well, enough's enough. And they established co-ops. The Scottish Potato Co-op is now in play. They now have 15% market share of UK production, supplying near enough 100,000 tonnes of potatoes. They have 6 customers. And in this year, which has been a terrible year for people selling Ware potatoes, every single potato has been sold at either standard or at premium value. Mm. And that's only because they've done that together. If they had those 25 producers hadn't been there, some of them would have gone to the wall by now. So, and there are mechanisms in the bill to enable to do that.
Sarah.
Yeah, just to pick up on some of the points David made there around the wider supply chain, retailers and processors. And I think it's important to remember that the primary objective for both a manufacturer and a retailer is to supply product through the supply chain. To, you know, for a retailer to have product on the shelf, for a manufacturer or a processor to have raw material coming in that they can then make into a final product. And this kind of comes into a wider discussion that we've not quite touched on today around, you know, we're here talking about the Scottish Ag Bill. But we have to remember that this is also set in a context of global food security. Now, the war in Ukraine about 18 months ago gave us a flash forward of what climate change is going to do to our food systems over the next few years and, you know, in generations to come. And therefore, I think it becomes an absolute priority for us as a food-producing nation to remember that producing calories from Scotland that moves through our supply chains onto retail shelves and manufacturers in Scotland reduces our reliance on other parts of the world who are also going to be looking for those calories produced from food that aren't going to be able to be produced in places that they aren't. And I think that's really important because if we reduce our ability to produce food, produce calories in Scotland, we're then looking for those calories to be brought in from somewhere else. So the more that we can encourage, as Joe started with, you know, a couple of hours ago now, short, local, transparent supply chains, that benefits our society, our economy, our environment, but also benefits the world. There's a real opportunity for us to be global leaders by focusing on food production here at home.
I fully endorse what Sarah's just said, and also I would recommend the committee reviews the Environment Audit Committee's report published by the UK Parliament just last week, which basically, you know, in a much more long-winded way, said what Sarah just said, that, you know, climate, biodiversity and food security, not food production, food security are all inherently linked. And that committee is calling on the UK government in particular to really look at food security as a public good. Now, in an economist's head, it's not technically a public good, but it should be put alongside the likes of tackling climate change and biodiversity, food security. And remember, food security is all about affordability and availability. So it's back to some of the points we discussed earlier about ensuring that everyone in our society has access to nutritious, healthy, affordable food. And we're not going to do that if we run down our ability to do it here in Scotland or indeed the UK and become more reliant on other parts of the world who are also facing their own socioeconomic challenges around producing food.
Just clarify on that point.
Very briefly.
Yeah, food security is a public good, because my understanding has always been that food production, food security has never been regarded as a public good on the basis of public support.
I'll stick an economist's hat on. If you're an economist, it is not, because you buy it and sell it, so it has a price.
Right.
But the thinking in this day and age is that it should be regarded as a public good because it is so much in the public interest. And if we have market failure, market intervention, that's why governments across the world need to step into food security and food production as a consequence. Excellent. Technically, food is not a public good, but it is absolutely in the public interest that it's affordable, safe, nutritious, all the other things that we touched on earlier on. Okay. And that's why government needs to step in and ensure that you have the continuity of supply at the right price, at the right standard, et cetera, et cetera. And it also delivers in a way that is beneficial for our environment and so on.
I'm very conscious of time. Briefly, Jenny, and then I'm going to take Pete, and very briefly, Joe.
OK, Okay, well, to be very brief, can I just pick up on the idea of food security? Sarah, you said about calories. I think we need to just be clear the definition of food security is actually includes nutrition. So I think if we're looking at sort of what we're trying to achieve, it's food and nutrition security. So I think we've seen in lots of examples where the focus has only been on calories, and then down the line there have been consequences for health because of nutrients, etc. So I think when we talk about food security, we either talk about nutrition security or we're very clear that it isn't just calories.
Can we try and frame this within what's in the bill again? So if we need something that addresses food security, as Jim has mentioned, or Johnny, there is nothing in the bill about that, or the public good for food. So if you can frame your responses around what is in the bill or what needs to be in the bill to address your concerns, because again, we're at the business end, we're legislating for this stuff, and if it's important, where does it come in to the legislative process? I suppose that's really what we want to look at. Pete, and then Joe.
We support food production as being part of the bill, central objectives. I think the difficulty is that doesn't mean we keep producing the same things in the same way forever. You know, Scotland eats less than 1% of the barley it grows, its main crop. We don't eat it. It's one of the most nutritious things people can eat is barley. You know, we don't eat it. We don't eat very much of our wheat. You know, a very small portion of wheat we grow is fed to humans. It's fed to lots of other people in between or to drinks, but it's not fed to humans. So I think Jenny's absolutely right. This is about how do we nourish the people of Scotland well from our land. And some of that is continuing to produce red meat for export. You know, we're very good. You know, we're well set up for that. But we can't assume that the job is to maximise red meat production. It's not. It's to optimise red meat production. We need to increase production and consumption of vegetables and other high-fibre things that we can grow in Scotland really well. You know, so it's just, we absolutely support food production as a core of this agriculture bill, but let's not take that to mean we carry on doing exactly what we're doing now in exactly the same way in exactly the same places.
Joe.
Similarly, I would say we're not arguing or advocating for the status quo here. There is a change that's required through these objectives and policy alignment. If there was anything in this bill that could probably achieve some of this food security bit, would be to make sure it sinks in with Good Food Nation plans. I mean, we don't end up with siloed policies which almost compete. Good Food Nation can deliver a lot around food security, depending on what the plans, when they do come forward, look like. And they could synchronise in with this bill to make sure that when we talk about food, we are talking about what we eat and drink.
Johnny, on this topic.
Yeah, I'd echo entirely what Pete said about the fact we can't continue to do what we've always done with the same outcomes, with the same results. We do need to change the way in which we support agriculture to enable it to deliver on the challenges that we do face. However, where I do disagree slightly with Pete is about the fact that actually producing that grain, that he didn't say the word alcohol, but it goes into an alcohol industry which is actually really, really important to the economy of Scotland. And there are lots and lots of jobs and incomes and livelihoods and rural communities that depend upon our whiskey sector and other sectors. So I don't think we should downplay the fact that yes, you know, we need to produce high-quality, nutritious food, but we also need to produce, you know, sustain a whisky industry in particular is so important to the prosperity of the country. And then you could get into all sorts of debates about even producing the feedstock, if you like, for renewable energy. You know, producing energy, biomass, and all the rest of it, that doesn't go into the food chain, but is that part of that balance that we might have to find in terms of producing energy, and so on. So,
thank you. I'm going to suspend the meeting until 11:10 to allow for a top-up of coffee and a comfort break. We'll resume at 11:10.
I need that.
OK, well, we'll reconvene and we're going to move on to our third theme with a question from Beatrice Wishart.
Scottish Government officials stated that the rural support plan would be a summation of how rural support delivers against the four objectives and that it would be co-developed with the industry and stakeholders. So what level of detail do you think needs to be on the face of the bill in terms of producing and the content of the plan?
Pete? Well, just to elaborate on what I said earlier, I think, Deputy Convener, that the key thing is it sets out how spending public money is going to deliver the objectives we need to deliver. And at the moment, I think Finlay referred to this earlier on, there's a bit of a danger that the climate plan says sea agriculture and the biodiversity plan says sea agriculture and the agriculture plan says sea biodiversity, and that we never actually nail down the jelly and say what actually we're going to deliver here. So I think it's really important the rural support plan sets out very clearly over a five-year period how is this £700 million of public money going to deliver on food production, climate, nature, and if we want nutrition in there, on nutrition, what difference is it going to make, and the evidence for that. So if we're spending X amount on Tier 1, what's the intervention logic? What does that deliver? What does this amount on Tier 2 deliver? If we've got specific schemes, how many farmers do we think are going to take up that scheme? What difference will that make? It needs to be granular at that level to say, this is a plan for spending quite a lot of public money over 5 years. This is why we're spending it in this way. These are the alternatives we've considered for spending it. This is why we've chosen this way to consider it. It needs to be really granular. Otherwise, I think it doesn't give Parliament the opportunity to say, we're going to approve this secondary legislation for all these tiers and all these schemes, because you can't see the whole picture. And the danger is, in our book, is that you get asked to approve, possibly by, in quite a rushed timetable, instruments which set out Tier 1, Tier 2, Tier 3, Tier 4, but you look at them one at a time and you don't get to see the whole picture. So that's why I think it's really important that we have a rural support plan that's detailed and granular and that has an environmental assessment that's independent, that says this is what we think it's going to deliver, and that comes to Parliament before you approve the secondary legislation.
Johnny.
I would largely agree with what Pete's just said, actually, in terms of the rural support plan, in a way, sounds a bit more like a big strategic high-level thing at the moment, and what we actually really need, and Pete used the word several times just then about delivery. So how does it translate into delivery actions? And how will we then use the support framework around Tier 1, 2, 3 in particular, but also underpinned by Tier 4, to deliver on those actions? So in a sense, a rural support plan, I think, is high level, but we will need some sort of delivery plans underneath that, just as you do with any plan, whether it's a business plan or you know, in terms of trying to deliver a broader policy objective. I think the fundamental point from our point of view, though, around the rural support plan is that, yes, a five-year commitment on ministers to produce one, but I think it's worthless unless it is also backed with a five-year rural funding plan, if that's the right expression, to go alongside it. You need a support framework, a funding framework, that says that these would be the commitments in aggregate terms around underpinning that rural support plan. And then it's the debate and the discussion about how those funds are then allocated on the delivery aspects that Pete just referred to. But as well as having a rural support plan as an obligation on ministers in the bill, I think immediately after that, there should be an obligation on ministers to have a rural financial framework in place to underpin it.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Jenny, to give a perspective on the health, wellbeing and nutrition aspects of what might have to be in the plan.
Well, I mean, the first thing I think is particularly joining up with the Good Food Nation and sort of making sure that they're complementary. I would also say if you want to put in nutritious food, there has to be more in the bill about what that actually means, sort of. We spoke briefly about where in the supply chain, but if we're talking about health, nutrition and well-being, is that of the population in Scotland? Because then you're talking about what's being produced and where does it go? So there does, for me, needs to look at that whole sort of system of if the endpoint or one of the endpoints is to get a healthier nation, then you've got to think about if it's high quality means it's going to be more expensive. How do you get to some of the populations that most need some of the nutrition? And that may be particularly around the horticultural sector. But also, is it ending up at the health point? And if not, then I think that needs to sort of be thought through within the bill, that there can't be an assumption that because it's produced in Scotland, people in Scotland benefit from it. So I would say very much, if it's going to be healthy and nutritious food that you're talking about, I think there needs to be a bit more detail about that, because that's in the top line. But there's very little detail once you go further down in the bill to say what that is or how it's going to be, as you say, delivered. So I think there does need to be either more detail or a real think about what actually does it mean to be in there, as opposed to maybe just a term that sounds like we should be doing.
Yeah, OK. I'm going to bring a question from Karen and then Rachel.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I find that quite interesting. A lot of the feedback was in regard to, you know, particularly noting plans like the Good Food Nation plan, but also the National Environment Bill. There's a whole list here, land reform particularly coming up as well. And it's just how to tie that all in. And Jenny, you're saying there, you know, how do we look at good nutrition, healthy nation, how do we fit that in this bill? Would that not then just tie into the Good Food Nation plan? Can we then, so if this agri-bill within itself overarches all of these different things and encompasses that, then that would be quite a full and fulfilling document in itself.
Yes, I mean, I think it would be fabulous if it overarched all of these different areas, because there are sort of trade-offs, having to look at, you know, what land is used for what. And obviously we have a finite amount of land in Scotland. So I think having something overarching that actually talks to all the different sectors, you don't end up with this unintended consequences of, for example, exporting a lot of our best food without thinking about a healthy nation and where some of it should go. Obviously, there's the Human Rights Bill that's being discussed at the moment, and a right to food. So I think that needs to be part of it. And yes, using this as an umbrella to sort of say we will, you know, going forward, draw in some of these things to make sure that we're not contradicting things in other bills would be a significant way forward.
Convener, so one of the interesting points brought up for me was in regards to the food security aspect of this and how that fits into it. You know, we have seen an environment lately where there is that, yeah, upset in the markets and delivery to people and to supermarkets, and it is quite a concern in time. How can we then ensure that is included here? Do you see that as being something in specific, that do you think payments should be tied to production?
That's probably me. No, payments, I don't believe, should be tied to production. It doesn't necessarily drive efficiency. And clearly efficiency is one of our keys to meeting a number of challenges simultaneously. Nor do I think tying payments to production would be a step forward. I think it would be a step backwards, and things, people like the WTO would probably have a view on these sorts of things as well. But you do make a very valid point about how do we build sort of resilience into our whole food system. It actually goes back to Jenny's point about land use and how we utilise our land to best effect. And I noticed you said trade-off rather than balance. It is absolutely vital that we use this legislation, and yes, it has to relate to other things around our climate change update plan, our just transition plan for land use and agriculture, the Scottish biodiversity strategy coming forward, and all these other things have to connect, because the common denominator in so many ways is land use, and within that, the serious common denominator is agricultural land use. So rather than having payments based on blunt areas of occupation of land, which is the current model, which clearly doesn't work because that incentivises inertia, if nothing else, nor can we have payments based purely on production or volume of production, because it needs to be of quality rather than quantity. I think we've all agreed that. So importantly, this piece of legislation has to be the pathway to supporting farmers and crofters to produce in a way that delivers not only on high quality food, but all the other outcomes we're seeking at the same time. And that's the intention behind the new sort of tiered framework, whereby farmers and crofters will still get direct support payments, but less for occupying, just for occupying land, but more about how they manage the land and their farming enterprises to produce high quality food whilst at the same time delivering the outcomes that we want. So the support will remain vital, but the means of delivering that support must change, and this bill has to be the initial step in that process.
Pete, I think you want to come in on this.
I was just picking up on that point. The government's vision for agriculture, which came out last year, I think heads off saying we want to produce more of our own food sustainably from our own resources. And I think that's a worthy intention in the context of food insecurity. At the moment, there's not much overlap. It's the same with fishing, between what we produce and what we eat. And I think if we look back in 10 years' time, one of the successes of this bill, hopefully, is that there's more of an overlap between what we produce and what we eat. As Joe was saying earlier about short food chains, more vegetables being produced, more value added in Scotland to primary produce to create high-value nutritional products which are affordable to the wider population. So I think that's a worthy goal.
Excuse me, Joe would like to come in.
Convener, just to say, I think, from Scotland Food and Drink's perspective, there's sort of an entire landscape to look at within food and drink. And this bill feels like it's more at the production end of that food and drink landscape or supply chain. And our concern is as much about the demand end. So what are people eating and drinking? And in Scotland at the moment, we have a challenge in that some of the things we produce are unaffordable and inaccessible. But I would just say I would struggle to see how this bill would address that issue, which is possibly more about inequalities or poverty than it is about the food that we produce and the drink that we produce. So our strategy, sustaining Scotland, supplying the world, unfortunately cannot address, to the extent we'd love to address, getting nutritious, high-quality food into communities of high deprivation. And that, you know, it's just too much to expect this bill to achieve that outcome. It should link into Good Food Nation, which has some hope of potentially looking at the local community distribution type activity, including the critical role of the public sector in purchasing local, even if it costs a bit more, and obviously all the things that go with local, sustainable, etc. But there is a limit, I think, to what any of these bills can do in terms of deprivation, which underpins, unfortunately, a lot of the inequalities.
Again, I want to bring the focus back to we're looking at the rural support plan and what currently the legislation suggests needs to be considered within that plan. Yeah. And it suggests relates to agriculture, forestry, rural land use, environment, climate change plan, but it doesn't actually mention cost of food. It doesn't mention the Good Food Nation, so that's something it would appear that you're suggesting should potentially be in there.
We'll just ensure that it links across to it and doesn't try and override it or sit above it, but there needs to be some kind of mindfulness of what that work is doing as well. And that's, it's probably across other, as Johnny touched on, other policy areas as well.
Okay.
But how you join that together is quite complicated, I'd imagine.
Okay, I've got questions from Rachel, Ariane and Alistair.
Thanks, Convener. So the NFUS are calling for a funded commitment to accompany the rural support plan. Am I correct before I ask my question?
Yeah.
Considering the recent cuts to the agricultural budget, would you be confident that the rural support plan will be accompanied by the resources that you need to achieve the four objectives that have been laid out in the bill?
I don't think anybody can be confident about what funding settlements that either Westminster or Holyrood will provide for rural Scotland and delivering the outcomes that we want from this bill and what will follow from the bill. What is absolutely paramount in our view right now is to seek a multi-annual ring-fenced commitment from the Westminster government, whoever that might be, from 25 onwards or middle of 24 onwards, whatever it might be, for at least that parliamentary term to 2029. But not only ring-fenced and multi-annual, we need it to be significantly increased because the value of support has eroded in real terms, and yet farming and land management across the UK is being increasingly asked to do more. So that's the first ask. We need that commitment across a UK basis. If we then get that ring-fenced multi-annual commitment coming into Scotland, it's then about ensuring that the Scottish Government also adds to that to deliver on the outcomes and expectations that the Scottish Government places on farming and crofting to deliver that multitude of outcomes that the bill is asking us to do, because all of those things do come at cost. If we're going to meet our aspirations around all the things that we've talked about this morning, that fundamentally comes at cost. You cannot expect the delivery of public good, and we've talked about public goods quite a lot, at private cost on a sustainable basis. And if the market returns aren't there to cover those costs, then that's when the government sector has to intervene if we want to ensure that there's no market failure around those things. So there's an obligation on two governments. First of all, the Westminster government, to provide Scotland with that commitment that we've just received and is about to come out, run to an end in 2024. So we need a continuity in that respect, but then we need Scottish Government to add to that and then also allocate that to best effect to get the outcomes that we want.
OK, so in the situation that I referred to where the agricultural budget was increased, then that money was taken away. Are you then saying that the Scottish Government should ring-fence that money?
Well, the funding that Scottish Government currently gets from Westminster is ring-fenced, and that has been allocated to Scottish agriculture.
But not used for agriculture?
No. All the funding that has come from the UK Government to the Scottish Government, £620 million, has been allocated through basic payment scheme, LFAS, all the other things. Treasury have assured us of that, and the Scotland offices have assured us of that, let alone Scottish Government assuring us of that. The bit that hasn't been unallocated was additional funding that Scottish Government put into that budget.
OK, so are you saying that... So going back to the Rural Support Plan, to achieve the four objectives, are you saying that the money that the Scottish Government put in should be ring-fenced to agriculture?
We believe that agriculture and... Well, not just agriculture, but the rural economy and the rural communities bill and what it's trying to achieve should have a ring-fenced budget on a multi-annual basis. Okay. Because it's only then that you can actually plan with best effect, not only from a farming, crofting, land use communities point of view, but also the administrators of these of the schemes and the support payments. There is a clear plan in place that says this will be the financial profile over the next 5 years to match what you're trying to achieve with the rural support plan.
OK. So do you think there should be a consent mechanism in the Parliament to ensure that the importance that you're placing on the future of agriculture has the ability to maintain those funds rather than divert or defer them?
Yes, just as in the same way as I think there should be a mechanism in place to ensure that, you know, going back to Rhoda's question earlier on, that secondary legislation is properly scrutinised and agreed, not just by Scottish Government, but by the parliamentary process, because you need those checks and balances.
OK, thank you. So, to the wider panellists, a couple of questions. When would you like to see a draft rural support plan? Should there be a statutory requirement to consult? And how do you see the role of parliamentary scrutiny of a support plan, including monitoring and reporting on the effectiveness of the plan? Pete, start with you.
Perhaps 1st of January 2025. I think to come into Parliament, there's a difficulty because of the sunset clause that we've got in place on from the 2020 Act about what Scottish Government can do, because the last thing we want, I think we're all agreed, is any more delay in starting to make these changes and payments. But I don't think that means we should get things wrong because we're in a hurry. Because we've not, you know, we've been a bit slow, I think, and there's lots of reasons for that, but we have been a bit slow getting to this point. So I think we need to get that rural support plan and into Parliament. And I do think requirements to consult externally, I think the Welsh example of the Wellbeing Future Generations Commission is a good one. We'd certainly need to consult with the UKCCC, with nature bodies, and to make sure that the plan is robust. And there's a question about monitoring and evaluation throughout this. The CAP, you know, is externally evaluated by the European Court of Auditors. We're not quite sure what the external evaluation for this Scottish process is going to be, but does Audit Scotland have a role in it? Does somebody else have a look at this and say this is value for money or not? And I think that's really important to Parliament. I think another element in the plan needs to be, and I think Johnny would agree with this, that you know, the work you and others did, Kate, on the principles for responsible natural capital investment. Some of this work of changing things can be done through investment private finance. Scotland's looking at a major carbon and nature bonus coming our way, as well as renewable energy, because of the way our land is. But we have to make sure then that we're not doing things with public money, which private money could do, but equally we're compensating for the negative effects of private finance flooding in. And at the moment, the plan is a little bit in isolation from what private finance is going to do. And I think it's reasonable for the Rural Support Plan to set out where do we see the contribution of private finance and public finance sitting together. But we'd also want to see in the Rural Support Plan some clear targets for how much progress we're going to make on things and how we're going to measure that. Sarah mentioned the COP28. The FAO just brought a roadmap for food systems in a 1.5 world. It's got, you know, these are global big numbers, but really clear targets about where we want to be by when to deliver that.
Mr. Rhoda's got a query and something you've said, Pete. Rhoda.
Just a tiny supplementary to that. You're talking about the sunset clause and when this support plan has to come in place. Should we be using this legislation to remove the sunset clause to give more time to make sure we don't end up with unintended consequences?
I think that's above my pay grade. I'm not a lawyer, but I think that...
My understanding is something in the bill that allows an extension of the sunset.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. The main thing was just not to delay the change because we're waiting for the Rural Support Plan. I think everybody would agree on that.
Sarah.
Yeah, no, I'd agree with Pete that the 1st of January 2025 would probably be a compromise on both sides. I think it's really important to remember, particularly when we're talking about livestock production systems, that they are long term. And if you're looking for producers to make differences, make changes to how they produce food, you know, farmers might only buy a bull once every 5 years. So you have one chance, particularly potentially within that timeline of the Rural Support Plan, to influence their decision making. And I think, you know, we cannot lose sight of, you know, when we're talking about farming and crofting businesses, they are biological businesses impacted by things like the weather. It's not a closed loop system where you can just, you know, pull a lever and the production system changes. So having as long a run-in time as possible to give businesses the chance to prepare is good. And I also think it's important that we consult. I think consultation is good because it helps to explain the why, what it is we're trying to do to bring people with us, and then also allow the wider industry ecosystem round about farmers to also place themselves in the best way to help support that transition. And I think that is why it's worthwhile putting time into consultation, explaining the why, but also making sure we understand how businesses will react to different parts of that rural support plan, because there's no point in putting something in there if a business can't actually make a change within that time frame.
Thank you. Ali-Anne Burgess.
Yeah, I just want to say, Johnny, thanks for all that clarity around the multi-year funding, and because that was one of the questions I had around, you know, how is that possible if the UK government isn't coming forward with that? I wondered how you were getting on. I think you've been in conversation with them. And then the other simple question I have is that I think, Pete, in the Nourish evidence, written evidence, you were calling for longer than 5 years support plan, so I'd be interested. So maybe start with Johnny and come back to you.
Of course, on that funding question, we're dealing with a current UK government, but that current UK government, in all likelihood, has only got 12 more months to go, max. And therefore, you're looking at who will or might form the next UK government. So our responsibility on behalf of our members is to lobby all the political parties in Westminster to get commitments so that arguably you would have cross-party support on such a commitment. But certainly talking to all the leading parties in Westminster to seek, a multi-annual ring-fenced budget for the whole of the UK and increased in order that, you know, Scotland's share is safeguarded, if you like, for at least the 25 through to 29 period. And that then gives Scottish Government a foundation to build on that as the core budget, to then ensure that there are sufficient resources in there. And I've said many, many times, we could come up with the best ag bill in the world, the best schemes and measures and all the rest of it, but it's a house of cards if we have no funding behind it. So that, you know, that's always the elephant in the room, in my opinion, is if the resources aren't there, then we are really going to be struggling, because farming and crofting and the entire agri-food supply chain is being asked to do more, but with less. And I would agree, sorry, just to echo what Pete said, I think we've really got to get a bit more ambitious and a bit more creative about how do we lever in private sector finance as well. We can't simply keep relying on a public purse, which is already under significant pressure.
Pete, do you want to address the question on the longer plan?
Longer term. I think what I'd suggested in our evidence was that we have a 20-year horizon for this, that we look at for, you know, so that we're setting out from the beginning a long-term ambition that this first five-year plan fits into, lays the ground for, contributes to, you know, so that we've got our eyes on the longer-term prize. Because as Sarah says, you know, 20 years in the life of farming business actually isn't very long, but it's the only 20 years we've got to get to net zero and restore nature, and also to get us on a more prosperous trajectory. So just having an eye to that 20-year timescale. But I think the SIUC evidence was interesting, because it says, and I don't know if we can do this, try not to align them too closely with the parliamentary terms so that it doesn't become, you don't get a sort of hold-up when you're in the election year. That's all.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Can I just ask you if Johnny can build on some of his earlier points about that link between production and support? I appreciate it's a link, not a tie, but I wonder, we've heard earlier on from Leslie about the regime that is likely to exist for, say, for English hill farmers. So there is a distinction being made, or likely to be made, in policy in the two countries. So how, I suppose my question earlier on is, how do we ensure that we're able to act in a way that meets Scottish needs on this, and we're not pressurised into doing something that breaks that link completely in the way that may be happening in England?
I think that's a really, really important issue to raise in the context of how the bill and the powers within the bill will be used going forward. And as we're all aware, Scottish Government's intention is to produce a four-tiered system, with Tier 1 and Tier 2 being the sort of where the heavy lifting's done. The difference between what we're intending to do here in Scotland and what's happening in England is that we will retain a component of financial stability in Tier 1, which is very much equivalent to what we have under our basic payment scheme and our things like a less favoured area support scheme. That is absolutely critical. If you look at the profile of Scottish agriculture, to have that financial underpinning, that financial stability component, is vital for so many farming and crofting interests in Scotland. Yes, there are businesses and enterprises that can stand on their own two feet. There's no doubt about that. But, you know, traditionally, they've been relatively unsupported sectors like pigs and poultry, soft fruit, the vegetable sector and so on. But once we move into our sort of livestock, permanent grass, upland areas, the reliance on an element of direct support is critical. However, we are very, very clear that simply occupying an area of land to receive a support payment, to do the same old things that we've always done, is not going to cut it when we need to tackle new challenges. So therefore, the difference with the system we want to move to and where we are today is to ensure that that Tier 2 element of management options, the enhanced payment, is not about occupying land, but is about how you manage the land and how you manage your agricultural enterprises. And you're doing that in an efficient way, in an effective way that delivers on the environmental needs as well as the bottom line of the agricultural business. And that's the big departure. So the difference between ourselves and England, if we can draw that very direct comparable, is that their direct payments are being phased out completely and will do so by 2027. And for upland producers, and you know, certainly speaking to colleagues at NFU in England, upland producers in the north of England, down in the southwest, they are now on something of a cliff edge, to use that phrase which is being used a lot, because they don't have the options in terms of picking up the environmental measures and so on, to make that stack up as a viable business. And it goes back to a number of points that have been made. Unless you have that underpinning financial viability, you don't have the people on the ground to carry out the types of land management and high-quality food production that we actually want to achieve simultaneously. So that's the fundamental difference between what's happening in Scotland and in England. And as our President Martin Kennedy often says, he'd far rather be on this side of the border right now with that trajectory, rather than being on the other side of the border, facing actually some really stark choices. It's one thing if you're a big agribusiness in the southeast of England and you're market focused, you can just say, well, I actually don't need that. And I'll just farm, and I'll farm hard. So I think we'll see some perverse consequences in certain parts of England. It'll actually be counterproductive in terms of environmental delivery. Whereas actually, if you're a hill farmer on the Isle of Mull, you absolutely need that underpinning to ensure that you can continue to deliver the environmental and social contribution that you make to those areas. And that goes back to Kate's point about underpinning rural communities.
Thank you, Convener.
We sort of jumped there. Is there any members got any further questions on rural support plans? Yeah. Jim?
Johnny, you mentioned earlier on that you would look to see an increase in funding, largely because of inflation. So, let me ask the question, what justifies farming getting an increase in funding when every other sector across the country is looking for an increase in funding, largely because of inflation? Where's the justification for farming to get it?
I didn't say largely because of inflation. I said it's been eroded in real terms because of inflationary pressures.
My apologies.
But the real reason why we need an uplift in funding is that farming and crofting is being asked to do more. And that comes at a cost in terms of delivery of the outcomes that we all want to see. But they don't come without cost. And as I said earlier, you can't deliver those public goods, whether it's food security, climate, biodiversity, at private expense. Otherwise, that is the quickest way to run down the viability of agricultural businesses.
Currently, Scotland gets about 17% of the agricultural budget. I think I'm correct in saying
that.
If there is have you got any indication of whether that level of funding will continue to come to Scotland at that percentage rate, or is there a need for that to increase as well?
Well, that's why we're on record as asking for at least the UK government, the future UK government, to provide a further £1 billion at least for the whole of the UK, which means it was going from about 3.5 up to about 4.5 billion, of which currently Scotland gets 17%. Now, I'm also very clear that actually there's a strong justification for Scotland actually getting a bigger share of that budget. And if you go back to the Bew review of 2020, Lord Bew's recommendations, not only was it that Scotland should get this additional 25.7 million per year during the current spending review period, but actually he recommended to the UK government that there was a review of how those funding allocations were made across the UK. Those funding allocations were based on historic production levels, not on what we are doing in terms of delivering on climate, biodiversity and other things. And if you look at Scotland's land mass, and not just its land mass, but actually its comparative strength in things like peatland restoration, woodland creation, biodiversity, there is a very, very strong case that Scotland should receive more than 17%. I couldn't put a figure on it, but I would say at least quarter of the budget, 25%, should be coming to Scotland.
Michael Gove gave a commitment some time ago that under no circumstances would agriculture be barnetised on the basis of what you've just said. Have you got any concerns about that happening in the future?
If it wasn't ring-fenced on a multi-annual basis and just came part of the block grant, I'm pretty sure it would become barnetised and would fall from 17% of whatever that commitment would be to 9% or whatever it might be. And that would be effectively halving what we get. So that is an additional reason why we need it to be separated out. And it's quite clear that the UK government can give ring-fenced multi-annual commitments to certain sectors. There's a component of funding comes from UK government to the fisheries sector, for example, or indeed to different parts of UK government in terms of different departments. So that's the reason why, if it's ring-fenced and therefore those funds can only be used for specific purposes, it does not have to be barnetised. It's not part of the block grant. Now, it's not to stop Scottish government utilising what comes in the block grant to add to that, but essentially it's an effective separate budget. And retaining that in order to maintain that at least 17% share, and as I say, there's an argument for it going higher, is really, really important for all of us if we're going to achieve the outcomes we want.
OK, thank you.
Can I just ask on the multi-annual funding? John Kerr, one of the civil servants, said that it was a semantic around the multi-annual multi-annual year funding, which was promised by the UK government up until the end of the parliament. Would you say that that was multi-annual funding?
The commitment that George Eustace made in November 2020, which was basically a reiteration of the Tory party manifesto commitment of 2019, said multi-annual funding. And when Rishi Sunak was Chancellor of the Exchequer in the budget of 2021, his spending review then made it multi-annual. It was a three-year to the end of the Parliament to 2025, effectively. So in my opinion, it is multi-annual, and that's what we want to see repeated from the next UK government.
Okay. And there is one area that's just missed on the rural support plan, but if you might want to skim over it.
Just sticking to this topic, so up to now we've had multi-year funding ring-fenced, but again, I'm going to ask you, ring-fenced, and when's it ring-fenced when it's not ring-fenced? You talked about unallocated money, but there was £61 million taken out of what most people regarded as ring-fenced money, because the Bew Review, as you said, identified that Scotland didn't get enough money. But the Scottish Government took the decision to remove that from the agricultural budget. So was that part of the 17% that you mentioned, or was it over and above?
It was over and above.
So why do you think...
So let's be very, very clear. So the Scottish Government received £620 million per year from the UK Government as a ring-fenced contribution as part of the UK delivery of agriculture, excuse me, and rural development spending. We've had it on record from the UK Treasury and from the Scotland Office that £620 million has been spent. The piece that has been the uncommitted piece is additional funding that the Scottish Government provided to that rural economy budget. And therefore, it's not been taken out of the ring-fenced element.
So what happened to the Bew money, the £61 million additional?
That is part of the ring fence.
It was part of the £620 million?
Yes, because it was £595 million of direct support and other support. The Bew is the extra £25 million taken at £620 million.
Just to get this clear in my head, so the ring-fence money was all spent on agriculture?
Yes.
But the Scottish Government still removed how much from the
£33 million in September 22 and £28 million in November 23, making about £61 million.
Despite the inflationary pressures?
I'm just stating facts. You're obviously trying to draw me into something of a political discussion.
Well, I'm not, because you're asking for guarantees on ring-fenced funding and funding that was allocated to agriculture to be spent on agriculture, and that has not happened in the last couple of years.
Yes, the ring-fence has been spent. What hasn't been spent is the additional funding that the Scottish Government put in, and we're clearly on record as calling Scottish Government to return that. We've had meetings with the Deputy First Minister, and we've written last week to the First Minister seeking that be urgently addressed, that the money is fully returned and is allocated to appropriate use in that budget.
Okay. So when it comes to the five-year funding plan that we'd like to see go alongside the future rural plan, at the moment the expectation is that future farming funding should still be UK money. And not via the block grant, is that correct? So it would be UK government for agriculture. However, the bill would suggest that money could then be diverted wherever, as a saving or whatever. So it's not actually ring-fenced within the legislation that's in front of us. Is that right?
If it comes through the existing process, it would be ring-fenced and has to be spent on the elements or the purposes to which it is intended. That's exactly what UK Treasury were looking for.
Okay.
And whilst ring fencing is not a legal binding term, it is a commitment in that sense that any devolved administration who receives ring fence funding from Westminster cannot then shovel that sideways into other parts of spending.
Okay, thanks. Kate Forbes.
Can I just ask, is there not a danger there, going on the premise of the points that you've just made, that if the UK government don't ring fence it, they could then barnetise it?
They could simply allocate it through the block grant, and therefore it is not ring fenced.
Okay, thank you.
That's why our ask of whoever forms the next UK government is to effectively cut and paste the settlement that we've just had, over the last 5 years, but with additional funding in it. So it is ring-fenced. Scotland gets 17%, and actually the argument is we should get more because that was a recommendation of the Bew Review.
That'll be up to you guys.
Okay, Kate.
We just, very briefly on that point, and the distinction between ring-fencing and non-ring-fencing, and my, I would assume that the agricultural sector would is more interested in what is ring-fenced over the next 5 years because that provides a basic minimum guarantee, notwithstanding that future governments may wish to top that up in terms of devolved governments as additional commitments become available. But the real focus would be on ring-fencing and clearly extending that as much as possible.
I think your assumption is spot on.
And my second point is, just for the record, my understanding, notwithstanding your understandable concerns in terms of budget movements, that budget will be returned in subsequent budgets, according to the Cabinet Secretary. But clearly, again, the point being that you would prefer ring-fenced budgets, which ultimately come from the UK government. So that five-year plan is more important than anything else.
Yes. But clearly we have had it on verbally and in writing that that funding will be returned. Our continual request of Scottish Government is to say when and what will it be used for.
Thank you.
And that's the issue that still remains outstanding.
Thanks.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Well, we've kind of started to get into this area already, which is we wanted to move on to the section part two in the bill, which is the powers to provide support. So provisions in this section give Scottish Ministers powers to provide support and additional powers about support, so such as conditions, eligibility requirements, guidance, capping, refusing or recovering support and exceptional market conditions. So I'd be interested to hear from maybe not Pete and Johnny for a wee while, but good to hear from them too, but some other people to start around the level of what your thoughts are on the level of detail in the bill. And also your views around powers to cap the agricultural payments and the whole kind of potential for redistribution and also ideas of tapering. And we also started to touch in on the tier system and, you know, what kind of detail we might want in there. And also levels of power, parliamentary scrutiny. Let's start with all of that. And then I've got a special question for Professor Jenny McDermott as part of this.
Sarah, do you want to kick off?
Yeah, no, I just want to kick off by saying that we are fundamentally opposed to the concept of capping. We don't see any evidence from any other support schemes that capping has worked. And I think that there are different ways to deliver the outcome in some ways. And one of the best ways that we have seen used operated in recent years is this concept of front loading. And again, when we come down to businesses, there's quite often a cost of doing business that exists whether you're a large farm or a small farm. So this concept of front loading would actually help the small producers, you know, that we know who are more exposed to market volatility and the cost of doing business and are often in more geographically challenging locations, you know, in terms of that more holistic support. So I think I just wanted to make sure that that was part of our evidence, and I wanted to reiterate that again today. Around providing support to exceptional market conditions, I think this is something that should be fundamentally, you know, a strong part of this element of the bill. Again, reiterating it, in a climate crisis and a biodiversity crisis, we know that different parts of the globe are being impacted by weather events, by, you know, the ability to produce food, including our own. And it is important that we have the mechanisms within this bill to be able to support businesses, whether it's from disease, movement of disease. So, you know, the big challenge, worry at the moment is around African swine fever and, you know, will it ever reach our shores in the UK, and what ability do we have to protect our businesses here and mitigate against that as a market challenge. So I think it's really important that in this very, very uncertain, you know, geopolitical and, you know, wider landscape, that we have that ability to intervene quite rapidly to the different challenges that may come across our producers to maintain the business viability at the core. We're asking a lot of our businesses at the moment, you know, to change production methods, to reduce emissions, to invest in new pieces of technology. And I think, you know, if we're asking businesses to invest in the long term, it should be a piece of this legislation to say that actually, should something that we do not foresee right now, that we've got your back. That's risk mitigation. And I think that speaks very clearly to businesses to say, if you invest, we'll make sure that, you know, should something happen, that we're there for you at a really basic level.
Johnny.
Apologies. I appreciate you don't really want to hear from me anymore. what it does encourage us around part two of the bill is that there is clearly a lot of scope and a lot of flexibility within those powers. The bill creates the powers, and I've said time and time before, and I'll continue to say, it's then about ultimately how those powers are used. And that's going to be the key element. The important thing, though, is the flexibility. There are powers to provide support on say, a regional basis. There are powers to provide support on land quality, land type basis, which is good because that then creates an opportunity for things like a disadvantaged area support, where you might want additional support in our what is traditionally less favoured areas. There is powers to support particular enterprises, which again, you know, thinking about where we are today and coupled support within our circular beef sector is important. So that would still allow us opportunities to do that in some form. Albeit we might want to attach more conditions to that support in what we're trying to achieve. So you know, the scope of the powers, I think, is right. Because fundamentally we need that flexibility and we need that coverage. The big questions are, though, about how those powers are then used. And that's that, obviously, when you step away from the primary legislation into the secondary legislation. And can I just entirely endorse what Sarah's just said about capping? Front-loading would be a far smarter way to do things. And we have a history of front-loading. If you think about the previous iteration of the coupled support scheme that we have in the circular beef sector, the old beef calf scheme that had a significantly higher payment rate per calf for the first 10 calves, and that skewed things towards the smaller producer, towards particularly in the crofting counties and so on, where clearly the cost of production per unit, if you like, without the economies of scale, it's really important that we actually do that. So capping is a very blunt thing, but I think there are different ways to do things. And certainly the concept, which is also referred to in the bill of tapering payments, merits some looking at as well.
I've got Sarah and Leslie and then Pete. Sorry. Oh, beg your pardon, it was Pete. Sorry, Pete first.
Sorry. So it's the rural support plan, as we said, what Jim said, what's the justification for how we're spending these different bits of money? And Parliament needs to look at that and say, why are we spending money here rather than there? At the moment, if you look at the base budget, which is in the financial memorandum, around 89% of the budget is going to go for Tier 1 and Tier 2 measures, with only 11% for Tiers 3 and 4, which has to do a lot of the change management, heavy lifting, advice, training, support for cooperation, you know, support for organic, support for agroforestry, you know, capital investment. It's got a lot is expected Tier 3 and 4. And at the moment, the base budget isn't going to allow much for that. So
because my understanding of it,
Jim,
is,
sorry, through the convener.
My apologies, convener. My understanding of it is that Tier 1 and 2 may well be getting the vast majority of the funding, but there's going to be additional conditionality added into that, which will actually pave the way for Tier 3 and 4 to be able to do its work. And if I'm wrong...
No, absolutely. And as Johnny says, you know... Tier 2 is going to make a change to what farmers get paid to do. So all I'm saying is that Parliament needs to look at it. And around how is that budget going to deliver on things? So if you look at the moment at how we spend that money, we need probably to move more money to supporting supply chains rather than individual farms, particularly support the sort of vulnerable areas that Sarah's talked about. How can this bit of the economy, the bit of the rural economy, be supported? Because it's not just about individual farms, it's about supply chain. But the question is, at the moment, there are egregiously large payments going to wealthy businesses, which, as Johnny says, could stand on their own 2 feet. You know, very large payments going to businesses which are very prosperous. And that's not a good use of public money. And we need to scrutinise that when the rural support plan comes forward and says, are we spending this public money wisely? And I think it's important to say, whether we call it capping, whether we call it tapering, whether we call it degressivity, the whole point is that giving businesses very large sums of money, which they don't need, isn't a good use of public money. And Ireland, which is not the most unsuccessful livestock producer, has introduced very sharp degressivity so that €66,000 is as good as it gets if you're an Irish farmer in terms of base payments. So, and Ireland's managing to run the livestock industry that way. So I think we just have to scrutinise these things really carefully and not just assume that the way we spend the money at the moment is the way we're going to keep spending the money.
Leslie.
Just a very short and brief point. I think one of the key concerns that I have is the issue of transition. And if I had the time, we had the time, I would ask you, Johnny, about what you think it will cost to your members to enable that transition to happen, whether it be buying new equipment, it be new organisations, it be building new infrastructures for local networks and so on. But what it strikes me in this whole conversation is whatever powers we have, we need to be able to support that transition and potentially that yield gap that you get as people move to more regenerative systems. So simply that comes under consideration when you are looking at developing those support plans.
Thank you. Ariane, I think you had a question for Jenny.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Yeah, so I asked this question last week as well, but I'd be interested to hear from your perspective. You mentioned the cost of living crisis and people being able to access nutritious food. So in terms of support, I wondered what your thoughts are with the Scottish Government having powers to subsidise not just the production side, but also the sale price of certain foods like fruit and veg to help more people afford healthy, sustainable food.
Well, I think it should. Sort of, I know we're talking about the agricultural bill here, but I do think it has to be all the way through the supply chain if it's going to be affordable and it's going to make a difference in terms of health. So subsidising or giving payments to horticulture, for example, it needs to make sure that then provides a product that is affordable to people in terms of a cost of living crisis. We know that in terms of what people purchase if on a very, very low income, doesn't tend to be fruit and vegetables. It's expensive relative to other foods. So it's not, that's where you don't have a choice in terms of people talking about food choice. But when you're at that level of income, there isn't really a choice. And so I think, yes, it needs to be at both ends of the spectrum if you're actually going to sort of draw in health. I know this is, again, agricultural bill, but as Karen sort of said, can you make sure that, you know, it is a food systems approach? So, yeah, I think it has to come from both directions.
And in terms of your work on food systems, have you done any work on how the government could subsidise Scottish farmers and subsidise customers or the sale price and ensure that works for the Scottish farmers, because you're right, keeping it local? Is there any mechanisms in place for that that you're aware of?
I'm not aware of, but other people might be of that. And I think sort of some of the messaging, again, it's this how the messaging comes out. Sort of there's a very strong local fresh sort of view on fruit and vegetables, for example. In terms of fresh, it doesn't necessarily mean it's the most nutritious. So frozen vegetables can often be more nutritious. They may be more affordable. So I'm not sure how much link has been made there, but it definitely needs to be sort of a link through the food system, through the supply chain, to see what comes out the other end. And it's got to be sort of beneficial at both ends for the production, but also making sure that goes all the way through to something like the consumer.
Tim, would like to respond.
Yeah, just to draw a few of these bits together, really, in terms of Johnny, you know, talked about food production being public good, nutrition, environmental change, affordability, etc., then to come back to Leslie's question about do we know the cost of. So the dairy sector, I think it would be fair to say milk kind of fits a lot of these brackets in terms of something we can produce well in Scotland. It's very nutritious, has environmental progress to do. There's been an estimate that to achieve net zero would be 15p a litre. And to put it in the context of the current... I can't guarantee his exact price this week, but we're talking roughly 35p a litre is what farmers have been getting. So at the height of the cost of living crisis after Ukraine got 50p a litre. So the price that's come back is the amount of money that would be needed to hit net zero.
How much does it need to be net zero?
15p a litre.
15?
An additional 15.
Well, that, yeah.
An additional 15.
So, okay. So to come back then about income... Yeah. So basically, you know, to come back to the point about public good use of taxpayers' money to help contain that, and that's kind of the quantification of it.
No, sorry? It doesn't come for free. There is a cost associated with delivering these outcomes.
Absolutely. Rachel Hamilton.
I was
just want to challenge Professor McDermott on the concept that by supporting horticulturists that vegetables could become cheaper, because if you look at seasonal vegetables such as kale, turnips, potatoes, cabbage, kale, they're very affordable right now. What is the mechanism through this bill that you believe could be implemented in order to allow horticulturists to ultimately produce it for free to give to customers? Because that's what would happen. Through the lens of the bill.
Through the lens of the bill. Well, I guess it's where you decide to put subsidies. I mean, one thing I would say on certain produce in terms of local, going down to the consumer end, it's also got to look at what is desirable. And local may not always be desirable. But if you're trying to, say, make it more affordable, then I guess from a lay perspective, then that's where some of the subsidies are going to have to come in if it's not affordable to produce at the moment.
So how do you determine what is affordable and what is not affordable? So, for example, the things that I just talked about, like the cauliflower, the kale, the cabbage, the potatoes, the carrots. I mean, what I'm trying to establish, I think, is trying to work out through the lens of this bill what you're trying to suggest should be achieved if, say, a bag of carrots is currently 19 pence.
If it can be that and it can be profitable to produce that, but not necessarily consumers want to buy all of that. There's all sorts of complex issues, which Pete can probably go into a bit more, around it isn't just making something like that cheap. How do you sort of, what do you do with it? How does it form into sort of meals? We don't eat individual foods. So how can that, A, be desirable as a food compared to something else? I mean, one of the issues are you buy kale or get it at a very low price. If you're on a very low income, you can't afford to throw that away, and perhaps children won't eat it. There are other things that are safer to buy. So it's got to be a bigger picture, I think.
Okay,
I'm
so
not answering your question.
No, you absolutely are, because does this then mean that through the lens of this bill, what you're trying to do is achieve a change of culture or a change of attitude towards food?
I think it's a change of society in terms of the attitude to food, in terms of what people across the whole of the population are eating. We've not had a lot of success in changing diets over the last several decades, apart from probably making them worse. So it is looking at the whole culture of why people aren't doing it, and tying that up with what's being produced.
Thank you, conveners, giving me the eye.
Okay, sorry.
thank you. We're probably going to enter into the good food nation rather than what this bill is actually capable of delivering. I've got Pete and then I've got Tim, then a question from Rhoda.
Yes, just really following on that point, I think we can't expect this bill to do everything. Good food nation has to join up with it. But I think it is worth saying that the end point we all want to get to is where we support a stronger local food economy and more Scottish veg are ending up being eaten by Scottish people and more Scottish high-quality food is being eaten by Scottish people. And I think we already do have some mechanisms where we do that. We provide Best Start Foods, which potentially could bring a higher Scottish content in. We do have public procurement, and we still seem to be wrestling with getting more direct short food chains from Scottish farmers onto the public plate in schools and hospitals and prisons. We're still struggling with that, I think. But there's some really innovative stuff that's happening that we need to build on in terms of that. And some of it's happening in the third sector. Last night we were down at Empty Kitchens Full Hearts in Granton. They just about produced their 2 millionth meal made to support people in the local community. And we're discussing, what is it people like most about your meals? People said the vegetables. That's what the feedback they're getting from their customers, who they're supporting over a number of weeks when they're going through a difficult time with free, freshly cooked meals. And similarly, we've seen on Uist, fantastic project there, 500 meals on wheels going out using local Uist produce to vulnerable households. So there's the beginnings of this work happening, I think, and we need to join up those dots. And it's worth remembering the original US Farm Bill back in the 30s was all about supporting consumers to eat farm produce from the States. 80 years on, 80% of the budget in the Farm Bill goes to consumers, not to producers. Now, there's all sorts of problems with SNAP and the way it's turned out, but it is worth saying that you know, the US joined that up a long time ago, and we need to be thinking in Scotland about how we join this up so we're not just putting money in one end and but not getting the results we want out at the other end.
Thank you. Tim.
Yeah, just to come back to your terminology, convener, about the business end of the bill and the topic there. I mean, within part three of the bill, there's the very welcome power to modify the cap legislation around the fruit and veg aid scheme. Now, that whole scheme, the whole funding behind that, has enabled the continued production of affordable fruit and vegetables. And, you know, the reality of that is, I mean, there's three POs in Scotland who, between them, produce about 7-8% of UK vining peas, 15% of strawberries, and 20% of broccoli for £3 million a year. So, affordable food, high quality, environmental improvements, investment in technology for 0.5% of the overall agricultural budget. So, you know, there's a mechanism there that ultimately we should be looking, not to extend to all sectors, but certainly those sectors where there's not, where there's supply chain challenge and where there's a lack of price discovery.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Convener. Can I just turn to section 10, which is the refusal or recovery of support, where it's in the public interest, and ask people what they believe that to include, and when would funding be refused or recovered?
Pick up on that. Sarah.
I suppose this comes into, you know, the cross-compliance ecosystem that we have at the moment, where rural payments and services, you know, effectively audit farmers, will go out and they'll do a check on what they've claimed versus what they have delivered. There was quite a comprehensive piece of work done under Fergus Ewing in 2017, I think, or around that era, which looked at basically how we could ensure that we're delivering good public services, you know, good value for public money. But also, you know, in this space where we are asking things that are new of farmers, that we're not just going in with a very blunt instrument and saying, you know, you say that you have claimed a payment for establishing 10 hectares of wildflowers and there's only 8 hectares here. Well, yeah, it's because there's been a slug or a bird issue, etc. I think what was proposed there was more of a penalty, kind of red, yellow card, red card system, which worked to enable farmers rather than just being a blunt instrument around recovery. I would suggest that, you know, that's a piece of work that is re-looked at, because I think it involved a lot of stakeholder collaboration and potentially provided a lot of the building blocks. Brian Pack also did quite a comprehensive review of this back in, Johnny, how long ago?
2011.
Which again, there's still a lot of, you know, unactioned pieces in there that we could use to help build a better system than what is in place at the moment. Yeah.
Johnny.
Yeah, just to comment on what Sarah said there, I was actually part of that simplification task force that Fergus Ewing established, and it was effectively to look to see how we could create a bit more flexibility and simplicity within what was the CAP's rules and regulations around compliance. Now, I'm the first to put my hand up and say we absolutely have to have, going forward, and I think Pete echoed this earlier on, we have to have some sort of verification and audit process to ensure that, you know, we're not just throwing taxpayer money and it's not accountable and all the rest of it. So we'll have to have that. But we also have to ensure that it's light and it's proportionate, but equally it's effective, so that it actually, we remove the fear factor for many farmers and crofters about breaching rules and regulations around the receipt of support. So I think we've got an opportunity here. But I'm not surprised that there's an element in the bill that says the ability to refuse or recover payments. I would have been really surprised if that wasn't in there. I think the key question, Rhoda, is what will that look like in practice in terms of that compliance framework and the ability to recover? What will be the inspection regime going forward? Because at the moment, we're still 90-odd percent governed by the rules and regulations of Europe. We did a cut and paste into Scots law under the Agriculture EU Retained Law Act of 2020. So I think there's this bill, one of the additional side benefits, if you like, is a chance to review how we put in place a compliance and an audit mechanism that is more suited to our needs and doesn't put the fear of God into farmers and crofters, or indeed those who are carrying out the inspections. And can I just make one point on about the carrots and the broccoli and other things? I think one thing we need to be really mindful of is actually how it goes back to that conversation we had earlier about risk and sharing risk. The cost of establishing a field, let's say 10 hectares of carrots or broccoli, runs into hundreds of thousands of pounds. That's the investment that farmers have to make up front. And then if we get, you know, extreme weather events, which we've seen certainly in Angus and Perthshire and southern Aberdeenshire recently, or indeed a supermarket just effectively saying, well, that's out of spec, I'm not having it. So all that risk is carried by the primary producer. And I'd add into that the availability of things like seasonal labour has been a big challenge and a concern over recent years as well. So there are plenty of people who are currently producing high-quality fruit and veg in Scotland, but if we let the risks escalate any further, then it's an easier and very much simpler decision to say, I'm not taking that risk, I'll just plant some grain, and then I'll really irritate peat and I'll sell it to some distiller. And that is the choice facing an awful, you know, and it's important. I mean, 1% of Scotland's land mass is under some sort of fruit and veg production, but it's 16% of agricultural output. Punches way above its weight. And we need to nurture and nourish that in many ways to actually grow that. But therefore, things like reducing the risk elements out of that, and there's lots of risks. And as I say, issues around labour and all these other things, the capital investment required, energy costs, all these other things which have really impacted on that sector is making people wobble right now. And that's the last thing we want to do.
Just before we move on to the last theme, you know, this is a very... The bill has got lots of scope, very little limitation on it. NFUS think it's a great bill. RSPB think it's a great bill. So it's all going to come down to the section of legislation, because it'll either deliver for NFUS or it'll deliver for RSPB. Or it might be somewhere in between. So you've talked about capping, and Pete has got his views on capping, or front-loading, as we might call it. And we know that the government already have the ability to cap. But is there any safeguards you would like to see before we leave it to secondary legislation relating to where the bulk of the money goes? So the NFUS would like 80% of the funding in Pillar 1. You know, what guarantees are you going to be able to deliver on that? What confidence have you got on the bill as it stands just now that you're going to get what you want? And Pete, what confidence have you got that you'll get what you want, and that is front loading and whatever? So as the bill says just now, how can you have any confidence going forward?
The bill is silent on things like funding allocations, and that's probably right. Yes, we're very clear that we want at least 80%, or that vast majority, 80% to go into the future direct support, which will be Tier 1 and Tier 2. Farmers and crofters will have to, you know, deliver on the outcomes required if they're going to unlock that support. If we put something like 80% on the face of the bill, but let's say that budget was actually cut from 600 whatever, or 700 odd million, down to 300 million, 80% ain't going to cut it. All of a sudden we're talking about... So you need flexibility in terms of what budget shares go into each of the different tiers, because you don't know what your absolute amount to start with is. So that would create, overnight, the cliff edge that we all refer to and they all say we have to avoid if we want a just transition out of this process. So having that sort of thing on the face of the bill or even in the explanatory notes, I don't think would be helpful. Because there are unknowns, we need to have the ability to put that into the secondary legislation. There are so many unknowns that we cannot factor into the face of the bill because we don't know what the funding settlement will be in absolute terms, and therefore why would we say 80% is what we need, but when it might be actually 100% or near 100%, or it might be 60%.
OK, Pete.
I think the main thing is bring forward the rural support plan before the secondary legislation, because we need to have that logical setting out of why we're spending money on these schemes, what are we going to deliver as a result of these schemes. Some of the current schemes are dead weight, and everybody agrees with that, that they've led to inertia. They haven't been helpful. So if we're going to keep spending that money in that way, we have to justify why we're spending that money in that way and not on other things. I think from our point of view, and for RSVB as well, if I speak for them, is that we need to see more money going into the engines of change in Tier 3 and Tier 4, particularly around innovation. The UK now, England has innovation grants for farmers. We don't spend nearly enough money on innovation. We don't spend enough money on cooperation and supply chain support, on farmer clusters. We don't spend enough money on agroforestry. It's good we've got commitment to organics and we need to follow through on that. We don't spend nearly enough money on up the farm track advice, direct advice to farmers that we're going to need to support through this transition. So the main thing is not to treat tiers 3 and 4 as a residual budget, which is whatever's left over once tiers 1 and 2 have had their say. We need to give those equal status because we won't get the change we need without investing at that end.
No. Do you mean that in terms of mindset of how what is set to deliver or volume of cash?
Well, both, I think. It's having a strategic approach to managing this transformation for food, climate and nature in Scottish agriculture over a 20-year period, initially with the first five-year plan. But I think so it's a mindset thing. These other engines of change are really, really important. We did a big consultation exercise supported by the Scottish Government this time last year, and people came up with all sorts of ideas for how to spend Tier 3 and 4 money and wanted to see more cash going into those. Mm. We can't decide how much cash is needed until we have the Rural Support Plan, but I think the Rural Support Plan should come forward and say, if it's 10 million quid a year for advisory services, what will that deliver? If it's 20 million quid a year, what will that deliver? If it's 10 million quid for cooperation, what will that deliver? We need to have those figures in the Rural Support Plan so Parliament can scrutinise that and say, OK, for now, for the first 5 years, that's a good way of spending public money.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, can I just come in there? And say
very briefly, Johnny.
Actually, that transition piece is critical because, you know, we are saying 80% in direct support today, but in 5 years' time, we might be actually saying that those balances are shifted. So if you put it into the primary legislation, you kind of looked into that. Mm-hmm. And I go back to the point, 80% or 20% of what? That's the fundamental question.
I don't think anybody's suggesting a percentage per se. It was NFUS that came up saying they were wanting 80% at this point.
But in the bill. This is about how we allocate the funding we get going forward.
Absolutely, but it's the direction of travel that we need to be clear of rather than any specific amounts of money or percentages. It's you know, you talked about a transition. There's very little about transition on the face of the bill. That's not there. We might think that's going to be part of the process, but currently there's nothing to legislate for that transition. Beatrice, a final theme.
Final theme, and I think it was touched on at the beginning of the session, I think by Sarah. So interested to hear views on the power to provide for continuing professional development, and are there any areas where you think CPD should be required or particularly encouraged?
Instance. So I think that alongside any capital grant funding and any direct support, you need to have a really strong CPD system. I think there's a couple of you know, CPD is not something, you know, a new concept. It's used for almost every professional working environment. And I think what's important with farming and crofting and supply chain associated is that it is led by the businesses. So, for example, Quality Meat Scotland has run the Monitor Farm programme through government funding for the last, I think, 20 years, and that has provided, you know, communities with the tools, you know, bringing experts in to the local communities, working with local farmers to help share knowledge that already exists. Farmers learn best from other farmers, and I think it's important that we can't just use blunt instruments that work for the accountancy sector, but we provide the tools, the toolboxes, effectively, for businesses to take what they need from them, and in enabling time to be spent on that. We have a lot of single operator businesses within our supply chain, so providing time for, you know, people to be away from animals, and, you know, is important that we get that style of CPD correct. But I do think it is really important that any grant system or any direct support is aligned with a really comprehensive CPD knowledge exchange, knowledge transfer system, or an ACIS system, and that also allows for innovation. You know, we can't forget about the role of innovation in this as well.
Yes, thank you. You know, I agree with Sarah. You know, CPD is an important aspect of many professions, I'd say farming is absolutely a profession. It takes a lot of expertise and skill and continual learning to do it well. And there's a really exciting opportunity within this bit, I would say, of the bill to join up what we keep asking for, which is joining up the production and then the demand side of the supply chain. And CPD could really help with that in terms of helping farmers and agricultural workers to understand the market opportunities that exist for their products, what's coming next. We try and do that with our manufacturing members, but absolutely could be doing it with primary producers too, I think, and could form part of this.
Johnny.
Yeah, well, I would echo what's just been said by Sarah and Joe. You know, I think it's fundamental that the whole issue that we need to wrestle with as an industry is about managed change, and that CPD element and the advisory services and the stuff Pete referred to in the sort of tier four element, it is going to be critical in terms of enabling change and enabling us doing things differently. So in that context, as a principle, absolutely have no difficulty with it being part of the bill. But there is a key word in there, and it's not, I don't think it's enforcement, but it's effectively making that CPD compulsory. And that, I think, is where we need to tread with extreme caution. That's the bit that I think we need to really think very carefully about, because actually, if that then excludes individuals from direct support because they are not able or indeed have the opportunity to do the right sort of CPD at the right time, that they are then have their support withdrawn, going back to Rhoda's point, then that's probably the ones that we actually want, we might not want to lose. They're the ones we actually want to improve in terms of their performance and so on. So I just think the way in which it is applied will be critical. And the bit about enforcement of CPD is what gives me concern. Not the principle is absolutely right.
So in your view, does it need to change? Because there is the line you're referring to is that persons must...
Must.
Well, it says may or must, but, you know, let's lead it as must. Meet a minimum criterion for successful completion of CPD. Does that mean you need to get 20 out of 30 or scores, whatever, successful completion, monitoring and whatever, charging of fees? There's a whole range of things that must be included. So
for,
how do you
and for many that might be easy and accessible, going back to Sarah's point about monitor farms and all that sort of thing, but it might not be the case for certain individuals in certain circumstances that they can do that similar sort of CPD as others. So if that then becomes an eligibility requirement to unlock support, I think that's wrong.
So this, in your view, this may need to be amended on the face of the bill, because it does suggest that, as you say, that there might be a minimum requirement to milk cows or to produce beef if you don't come up to a certain standard, because the legislation on that will be subject to negative. Again, providing very little ability for the Parliament to scrutinise that. So that may be something that we need to look at in a bit more depth. Pete?
Just to say, I mean, I actually agree. I think making something compulsory at this stage in the process potentially generates resistance we don't need. You know, David will confirm that a lot of existing farms already have to do CPD as part of the contracts with retailers. That's common, you know. And, you know, it's better for QMS to put it in as an expectation for their standards, their farm food standards, than to make it compulsory, because then if you want to sell your product, you've got to have some CPD. I think for a few years, you know, sell people really high quality CPD, stuff that's interesting and engaging and that they enjoy doing. And then if in 2030 we think, oh, there's still some farmers who are going, no, I'm not learning anything, you know, then I think you look at, well, actually, can you keep on getting public money? But it feels to us that the last thing we want to do is to sell a good thing by telling people they have to have it.
Yeah. David?
Okay. I mean, just to confirm that and to agree with Joe that there's an opportunity in here to support the broader supply chain as well. So, yeah.
Thank you. Leslie?
Exactly to that point. I think, first of all, incentives are better than compulsory. Secondly,
I worry about barriers to entry around cost of having to do things that are compulsory and what that does to smaller farmers. But the biggest thing from my experience of having looked at regenerative agriculture transformation across a number of different countries, India and the US as well, has been that you have to look at the whole supply chain, because it's actually actors like procurement managers in organisations that are the ones who hold the difference to change, and also that businesses are orientated around those new requirements as well. There's an organisation called the Future Food Movement who are doing exactly that, and they are working with whole organisations to build that capacity and capability within supply chains in food companies.
Thank you. Any other points or comments?
Just Jim. Something that popped into my head, and it may be absolute nonsense, so please feel free to shoot it down, is that farmers who are going back to the point that you were talking about, David, farmers going through particular requirements to supply whoever. You've got QMS, you've got Tesco, you've got Marks and Spencer, you've got all of these different schemes, all asking different things. And if we want to make this as simple as possible for farmers who are already fully stretched to the limit of their resilience in terms of being able to continue to do what they're doing, is there not an opportunity in this to be able to have one single scheme that everybody accepts that that's the standard that it should be? And I'm talking purely from the farmer's point of view, saying, oh my God, here's another layer of something that we're going to have to deal with. So how do we take that burden off of them and allow it to be something that they want to buy into?
Sarah.
I would say my experience of working with different retailers and different processors is that that would be very difficult to do, because different retailers are always looking to achieve different outcomes. And I think what...
them trying to get a market advantage.
Exactly. What I think is important is that there could be funding given through this mechanism to provide a suite of options that can then be tailored to different supply chains and to different processors and retailers. I think that as we look at RICS as the CPD scheme for, you know, land agents and things, they have a suite of different options that land agents can access, whether it's things like, you know, reading local papers, you know, the Scottish Farmer or the Farmers Weekly, attending events or attending a longer term training programme that give different levels of points, basically. What was kind of flashed through my head as well, could you use this as an opportunity to incentivise the bringing in of young people to businesses, and say that, you know, if a business has a younger person working, you know, as part of the business partnership, you know, that actually that automatically creates a kind of tick in that CPD box because they may have more recently been to ag college, university. There's different ways to do this. I think the important thing is that the bill provides the mechanism for funding that then has input from industry to make sure that the courses and suite of options are suitable for what supply chains require.
But doesn't that, again, allow the supermarkets or the big retailers to put that pressure back onto the farmer in order to achieve something for them, because they're looking for a market differentiation. So that's loading it back onto the farming community.
I think you could see it like that, but you could also see it that if that retailer...
Finish the point that was in my head. It stopped. It's that whole market supply chain.
Yeah.
So is there something in here that we should be looking at from the whole market? You know, we talked previously about the supermarket adjudicator only stops at that door rather than going right through the whole supply chain. So is there not something in here that we should be thinking about in terms of, if we're going to put that CPD in there, it's everybody's responsibility, but not to the point where it's all detrimental to the farmers?
I think farmers as businesses will make the decision about whether they want to service a particular supply chain and what the demands of that supply chain is. So if one supply chain is asking a farmer to do a higher amount of CPD than they are willing to do, then they may choose to service another supply chain, which is then a detriment to that retailer because then they don't have that same option of suppliers. That's where I think it's really important to have the core principle and a wide suite of options for CPD, that producers can make that informed choice themselves based on their business, their capacity, and actually what they want to achieve of their own individual business outcomes, you know. And that's where I think the flexibility is important. But and ultimately, if you don't have that within the bill, you know, bringing it back to the face of the bill, you won't then be able to tailor it to individual supply chains and individual retailers and processors.
Thank you. Johnny.
Yeah, I mean, Jim, you've opened up a complete can of worms, and it's not just in respect of CPD. I would say fundamentally what we need to get to is whatever the supply chain is asking of the individual producer, that is also then recognised by government in terms of the support payments that might be associated with that business. So if you're being asked to do a carbon audit, nutrient management plan, waste plan, animal health and welfare plan, because of your commitment to a contract or whatever it might be, or to access a market, then that has to be recognised as being equivalent in order to complete your whole farm plan, which might be an eligibility requirement for your future Tier 1 or Tier 2 payment. Mm. The last thing we want is a multitude of different asks for essentially the same things. Otherwise, that will send many farmers, you know, even more.
Okay, so let me be
in reverse. Then.
Sorry, convener, are you okay for me? Because this really
as long as it relates to the bill.
It does relate to the bill, because what that then does is we've all talked about the ability for the government to come under scrutiny to say, how are we spending this money? So if Tesco's Marks and Spencer's and any other supermarket says, these are the requirements for you to come and supply us, and the government says, well, OK, so you don't have to do that. There's therefore no scrutiny other than you're asking the supermarkets to then be your credit checkers. You see what I mean?
Yeah, but I don't think it works that way. I mean, we've got quality assurance in place, and I would have thought membership of quality assurance should be a sufficient safeguard for government in terms of, you know, that's all verifiable.
Yeah.
Whether you're producing red meat, whether you're producing milk through a red tractor, quality assurance, whether SQC for our cereal sector. The vast majority of farm businesses are quality assured, and we want to ensure that they continue on that pathway.
So as long as there's one of these quality assurance schemes, then you're saying that should be sufficient?
That should be sufficient for Scottish Government to say that individual is operating at a standard above the minimum regulatory requirement, but they're also carrying out things like carbon audits, biodiversity, animal health and welfare plan, and other things. If we end up with this whole plethora of different demands for different reasons, and they're all slightly different, and they don't align, that's a recipe for disaster. I mean, that's just going to put people off, and that's, you know, going back to Pete's point, we need to actually engage and incentivise people to utilise things like their carbon audits, to understand where they can make good decisions around which Tier 2 options, for example, they might go into. It's about informing people rather than it being a compliance issue. Mm, yeah. These are decision-making tools that we want to get people to think about rather than, I've got to do this.
Mm. On that, so what if the decision of a business is not to take up single farm payments or
That's
any payments
their business
and
decision.
Whatever?
Always, it still is.
Yeah, but how do you then regulate for net zero?
Because you have the backstop of regulation. We've got existing regulations around all sorts of environmental standards and animal health and welfare standards, which are in regulation. They're called statutory management requirements right now under cross-compliance.
So do you have any fears
regardless of whether you get a direct support payment or not, you have to adhere to those conditions.
Yeah, but do you think there's any risk of this legislation resulting in what I think some places to refer to as freedom farming? So they just go, we can actually run a business without having to comply with all these things. And to get payments, we'll abide by the environmental rules, we'll listen to SEPA, we'll do all that, but actually we're going to freedom farm. Do you think there's any risk of any businesses opting out of the support system?
Yes.
Yeah,
because we're seeing it happen south of the border.
Thank you.
Can I explain a wee bit more? By opting out of the support system, you are no longer subject to things like good agricultural environmental condition. And actually, that's a really important lever for any government to sort of use with farmers to say, we need you to do X, Y, and Z. Because if you're not taking that payment, you're not under that obligation.
Yeah.
And you are left to just those basic regulatory requirements. And it's very, very difficult then to say what's in the public interest if there's been a breach of those. The biggest deterrent or the biggest incentive to comply is actually the loss of direct support. And I think we don't want to lose that. So keep the direct support and the conditions attached, and then you'll get the outcomes from farmers and crofters.
OK, thank you. And bring in Tim for a last word on this.
Yeah, I mean, I was just going to say on that one, I mean, certainly we don't want to decouple the use of those levers. But I think in reality, for most products, most supply chains, then freedom farming, inverted commas, is probably less of a risk because most market supply chains are miles ahead of where government legislation and regulations are. Yeah. Come to Jim's point, yeah. I think it's really around just smart collection of data. How we use data. It's not very difficult to record whether someone's quality assured or whether they've passed X number of course with some supplier. Let's collect that data, report it back, and then government add this validated data in beneath it.
Okay, thank you. Rachel, did you have a very small...
Pete had his hand up.
You want to come back in on that?
To back up Tim's point about supply chains are going to do a lot of this, but I think actually enforcing environmental standards is still a challenge, and it's going to be a challenge as this goes forward for the people who do end up straightening the rivers or, you know, digging up a rocky knoll because they have a bigger field. You know, those things do happen. We don't have a hugely good track record of actually making sure that we get on top of those things. So I think what goes with this bill and with the Natural Environment Bill is a, you know, not a punitive compliance regime, but an effective compliance regime.
On a different topic, as long as it's a very brief question,
yes, no responses. Convener, thank you. Yesterday we received a GIQ and the government response to the timetable of the Land Reform Bill. A number of people in the room today have mentioned which cross-section legislation ministers should have regard to, and one of them being land reform. Now, that has been delayed, and I think it is incumbent on this committee to seek clarification from Marie Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary, when that we'll see a draft of that bill. Okay. In relation to this bill, it's our agricultural bill.
Okay, I don't know if any witnesses want to respond to that. I think, yeah, we can certainly write to the Minister and ask for a clearer idea when the Land Reform Bill will be laid. Okay, well, that's been a mammoth session, but it's been fun-filled, and we've got a lot of information to digest ahead of our Stage 1 report. So thank you all very much for your time commitment this morning. It's very much appreciated. I now formally close this meeting.